हेलो। हाँ गुड मॉर्निंग सर, गायकवाड़ सर बोल। हाँ प्लीज करो। सावंत
हेलो
सर,
भाई,
माझा
कुछ
आवाज येतोय व्यवस्थित?
हो गया, कुछ देते हो? हाँ
येतोय ना? ओके। हाँ रमोत्रा सर, गुड मॉर्निंग, आवाज येतोय का? रमोत्रा सर, तुमचं साउंड ऑन करा।
हाँ, किया है साउंड ऑन। हाँ,
ओके ओके सर। हाँ हो गया।
थैंक यू वेरी मच।
ओके सर, ओके, थैंक यू। एक मिनटात आमचे प्राचार्य पण ज्वाइन होत आहेत।
श्योर।
रमोत्रा सर, गुड मॉर्निंग। इट्स अ
वेरी
प्लेजर
गुड
टू लिसन।
मॉर्निंग सर।
It's a pleasure to hear you.
थैंक यू सर। आनंद
नमस्कार डॉक्टर गायकवाड़।
हाँ नमस्ते। हाँ तेंदुलकर सर, वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग
ओ
सर, नमस्ते। हाँ
हाँ, वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग।
हाँ आवाज येतोय माझा?
हो, येतोय। माझ्याकडे थोडासा कनेक्टिविटीचा इश्यू आहे। मी मोबाईल थ्रू कनेक्ट केलंय,
होय का?
ट्राइंग टू सॉर्ट
ओके।
आउट,
हाँ ओके ओके सर।
होईल जास्त करून।
हाँ। आणि प्रेझेंटेशन आहे का,
हाँ,
पीपीटी?
प्रेझेंटेशन आहे, काय करू,
हाँ
पाठवू?
मैं तुम्हाला होस्ट करतो, को
हाँ
होस्ट करतो, सुरेंद्र सर
हाँ
आणि
नंतर
तुम्ही।
करा, एवढ्यात काय हे नकोय,
हाँ हाँ
जरा
नंतर।
ट्रायल घेऊन बघूया।
हो।
सर माझं पण बघूया का प्रेझेंटेशन?
हाँ एक 2 मिनिटात आपण हे करूया, अगोदर इनॉग्रेशन हे करूया। तुमचं पण आहे ना
हाँ
सर प्रेझेंटेशन?
हो, मी ईमेल पण केले आहे
हो।
आणि
आणि
माझे।
तुम्हाला आपण होस्ट करतो, मग तुम्ही तिथून शेअर करू शकता सर।
हो, चालेल।
आणि आपण यूट्यूबची पण लिंक टाकलेली आहे, तर यूट्यूबची लिंक सुद्धा एखादा जर जॉईन नाही झाले शेवटी तर ते आपापल्या ग्रुपवर टाकू शकतो। मी व्हॉट्सअपच्या ग्रुपवर टाकतोच।
गायकवाड सर, आम्ही आमच्या प्राचार्यांना सांगितलं व्हॅलिडेटरीलाच या म्हणून।
होय का? ओके ओके सर, नो
हां
प्रॉब्लेम। त्यावेळी फक्त आपण आठवण करून देऊया
हो, मी
आणि
आहे तिथे,
मग।
मी कॉलेजलाच आहे।
हो।
बाकी मग कशाला त्यांना त्यांचं काम करून घेतील.
हो हो नो प्रॉब्लेम सर. लगेच सुरू करूया. आमचे प्रिन्सिपल आलेले आहेत.
जरा हे बघा चेहरा बिरा दिसतोय काय.
दिवटे सर बळवंत सर जॉईन झाले का. हॅलो.
हा नाहीच झाले अजून.
एकच मिनिट.
तेंडुलकर सर एक जॉईन नाहीत आणखीन. हॅलो गायकवाड सर. गायकवाड सर. हॅलो. गायकवाड सर माझा आवाज येतोय का. हॅलो. गायकवाड सर आवाज येतोय का माझा.
हा येतोय येतोय सर. आवाज येतोय व्यवस्थित सगळ्यांचा.
तेंडुलकर सर एक जॉईन झालेले नाहीत अजून.
हा ते झालते जॉईन जस्ट. मला म्हटलं थोडा नेटचा इश्यू असल्यामुळे मी लगेच जॉईन होतो परत.
नाही सचिन सर आहेत ते. सचिन तेंडुलकर त्यांचं नाव आहे.
सचिन तेंडुलकर सर आहेत की. सचिन तेंडुलकर सर
आहेत. फक्त सचिन लिहिलंय त्याच्यामुळे मी सॉरी सर शोधत होतो. को होस्ट केले.
हो
सर्व पार्टिसिपेंटना विनंती आहे. सहभागी झालेल्या वेबिनार साठी सहभागी झालेल्या सर्व सहभागींना विनंती आहे की कृपया आपले माईक जे आहेत ते अनम्यूट करून ठेवावेत. जेणेकरून कार्यक्रम चालू असताना रिसोर्स पर्सनला कुठला त्रास होणार नाही.
रिक्वेस्ट टू ऑल पार्टिसिपंट प्लीज युअर माइक इज अनम्यूट.
I request all participants, please unmute your mic.
Hello, Balwant sir.
Balwant sir, अजून जॉईन झालेला आहे तो.
झालेत खाली.
हां झाले 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 झाले.
हां गुड मॉर्निंग बळवंत सर, आवाज येतोय का?
हां येतोय आवाज येतोय सर.
ओके सर, आमचे प्राचार्य जॉईन झालेत, आपण सुरू करूया सर.
हां करतो.
करा करा, किती पार्टिसिपेशन झालंय सर? छान आहे, चांगलं आहे, करा सुरू.
सदू सर
सुरू करा.
सदू सर च्या वर झाले.
करा करा करा, हरकत नाही.
ओके सर, ओके थँक्यू.
सर्व ऑनलाईन वेबिनार मध्ये सहभागी झालेल्या सर्व प्राध्यापक आणि रिसोर्स पर्सनचं विद्यार्थ्यांचं भूगोलशास्त्र विभाग दहिवडी कॉलेज दहिवडी आणि पार्वतीबाई चौगुले कॉलेज मडगाव गोवा यांच्या वतीनं मी सहर्ष स्वागत करतो सगळ्यांना. गुड मॉर्निंग. दहिवडी रयत शिक्षण संस्था दहिवडी कॉलेज दहिवडी ऑर्गनायझेस वन डे नॅशनल वेबिनार इन कॉलॅबोरेशन विथ पार्वतीबाई चौगुली कॉलेज मडगाव गोवा, स्पॉन्सर्ड बाय ICSSR ऑन सस्टेनेबल डेव्हलपमेंट ऑफ रेन वॉटर हार्वेस्टिंग अँड आर्टिफिशियल ग्राउंड वॉटर रिचार्ज इन इंडिया. हार्टली वेलकम ऑल पार्टिसिपेंट्स अँड डेलिगेट्स इन दिस वेबिनार. आय रिक्वेस्ट कन्व्हेनर ऑफ द वेबिनार डॉक्टर गायकवाड, प्लीज इंट्रोड्यूस द थीम अँड वेलकम द ऑल पार्टिसिपेंट्स अँड डेलिगेट्स.
गायकवाड. थँक्यू सर, थँक्यू. हॅलो एव्हरी वन, गुड मॉर्निंग अँड वेलकम. रयत शिक्षण संस्था दहिवडी कॉलेज दहिवडी डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ ज्योग्राफी ऑर्गनाइज नॅशनल वेबिनार इन कॉलॅबोरेशन विथ पार्वतीबाई चौगुले कॉलेज ऑटोनॉमस मडगाव गोवा. वेबिनार इज स्पॉन्सर्ड बाय ICSSR इम्प्रेस रिसर्च प्रोजेक्ट अँड दिस टायटल ऑफ दिस वेबिनार इज Sustainable Development of Rainwater Harvesting and Artificial Groundwater Recharge in India. Firstly, I would like to thank Dahivadi College Principal Dr. B.S. Balwant sir, then IQAC Coordinator Dr. A.N. Dadas to give permission of organize this national webinar. We very much thank to Principal Dr. Shaila Ganti Madam, Parvitabhai Chaugule College, Madgaon, Goa, to permitted this jointly organized national webinar. Sir, we organize every year one or two activities under the MOU with Parvitabhai Chaugule College, Madgaon. Then, my friend and today's keynote speaker Dr. NN Sawant, former principal and head department of geography Parvatibai Chaugule College Madgaon Goa, who loves every time our college and guide us forever. I sincerely thanks Dr. Sawant sir for his valuable help in the webinar topic, also program schedule and this webinar. Search the good resource person. Thank you very much to Dr. NN Sawant sir and welcome sir.
Thank you sir.
Then heartily welcome today's chief guest of inaugural function, Dr. K.C. Ramotra sir, former head and professor of Department of Geography, Shivaji University, Kolhapur. Sir is guide of my PhD work. He is the well-known personality in geography. He guided more than 15 students of PhD, then MPhil students. His national and international research paper is very important, and all geographers is used to reference. Sir is expert in also social geography and agriculture geography. So this topic is very known in my guide, Dr. Ramotra sir. Sir, thank you and welcome. Dr. Ramotra sir, welcome sir. Then I welcome to my dear friend, Dr. Sambhaji Shinde, who is chairman of BIOS in Geography and Geology of Shivaji University, Kolhapur, and professor and head department of geography, Shivaji University, Kolhapur. He has definitely inspired us every time for organizing various activities with us. Welcome, Dr. Sambhaji Shinde, sir. I heartily welcome and thanks to today's national webinar resource persons, Dr. Surendra Thakur Desai, sir, head department of Gokte Joglekar College, Ratnagiri, affiliated to Mumbai University. He is the expert in rainwater harvesting techniques used in Kokan region of Maharashtra. Then another resource person, Dr. Sachin Tendulkar, sir, Chief Executive Officer, Mineral Foundation Goa. His NGO work on watershed development program and groundwater recharge. Sir, thank you and welcome, sir. I also welcome to today chairperson, Dr. Sanjay Gaikwad and Dr. Anil Edge, sir, from Parvatibai Chowgule College, Madgaon, Goa. My friend P.V. Patil, Prasanna Kumar Patil, sir, and all senior and junior participant in this webinar from various university in India and various university in Maharashtra. And last but not least, all my colleagues, students, welcome to all. And best wishes for grand success of this webinar. सर्वांचं मी मराठीतून पुन्हा एकदा सर्वांचं खूप खूप सहर्ष स्वागत करतो की आपण तुमचा अनमोल असा वेळ देऊन आपल्या या नॅशनल वेबिनारमध्ये सहभागी झाला. नक्कीच ह्या वेबिनारचा दिवसभराच्या प्रोग्राममध्ये आपल्याला फायदा होईल. आणि आजची जी पर्यावरणाची परिस्थिती आहे, निसर्गाची परिस्थिती आहे, त्यामध्ये रेन वॉटर हार्वेस्टिंगचा शाश्वत विकास कसा झाला पाहिजे, त्यामधून आपले जे ग्राउंड वॉटर रिचार्ज कसं झालं पाहिजे या संदर्भात आपण चर्चा करणार आहे. खरं तर हा ड्रॉटपोन एरिया मधला खूप मोठा प्रश्न आहे. तेवढ्या पुरताच फक्त मर्यादित नाही तर ऑल ओव्हर इंडियामध्ये हा प्रश्न आता अत्यंत गांभीर्याने घेतला पाहिजे. अशा प्रकारची चर्चा आमचे गाईड असतील, त्याचबरोबर आमचं डिपार्टमेंट, प्रिन्सिपल आणि सावंत सर यांच्यामध्ये झाली आणि आपण हा विषय ठरवलेला आहे. तर सर्वच माझे सिनियर सहकारी, त्याचबरोबर भूगोल विषयातले तज्ज्ञ, इतर विषयातले तज्ज्ञ आणि सर्वांचं पुन्हा एकदा मी मनपूर्वक स्वागत करतो आणि ह्या वेबिनारला सुरुवात करूया. डॉक्टर दिवटे सर, थँक्यू, थँक्यू व्हेरी मच सर. सर दिवटे सर, तुमचा आवाज येत नाही.
थँक यू सर. आय रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर प्रोफेसर डॉक्टर के सी रमोत्रा सर टू गाइड अस ऑन द टुडेज थीम ऑफ द वेबिनार.
हॅलो.
हा सर.
आर यू लिसनिंग टू मी?
हा येस सर, येस
येस. ओके सर, राईट. थँक यू व्हेरी मच गेटिंग मी जॉईन टू दिस वेबिनार, one day webinar on sustainable development of rainwater harvesting and artificial groundwater recharge in India. The topic which you have selected, really it's very appealing and in need of the hour, because the people in the country in different area where the water stress is being felt at large, and people are still using are overusing the water, and this is causing the problem. Now the topic which you have selected very nicely, and the person who has selected the topic has also worked on this PhD His PhD work is also on rainwater harvesting. And I felt that UAC and Chogle College, with which they are going to organize this webinar today on 4th June 2021, is really wonderful and very suitable of looking into the today's need and the stress of groundwater. In fact, therefore, I feel that, first of all, Dr. B.S. Sawant Balwant, Dr. B.S. Balwant, Chogle College, this Dehivadi College, Dehivadi, Satara, who is leading this college.
Hello, sir.
हा रमोत्र सर तुम आवाज
आवाज
माइक युअर माइक इज ऑफ सर
रमोत्र सर रमोत्र सर युअर माइक इज ऑफ रमोत्र सर
यस इज नाउ आर वी लिसनिंग
हो लिसनिंग
अगर दोबारा शुरू करो के जा
हाँ यश
स्टार्ट करो हाँ ओके सर Okay, thank you very much. So, the topic which we have selected for sustainable development of rainwater harvesting and artificial groundwater recharge in India feels very suitable. First of all, I am very much thankful Principal Dr. B.S. Balwant, Dehivadi College, Dehivadi Satara, who is leading the college for its academic development and the development of the society around the college itself by conducting various seminars, webinars, workshops, and other suitable seminars in the college. And that is in that involved geographers also. Dr. D.P. Gayakwad, Vijay Gayakwad, convener of this seminar, who has selected this topic very nicely, because the person who is involved here, Dr. Gayakwad, has also worked on rainwater harvesting for his PhD degree. So therefore, from Shivaji University, Kolhapur, and Dr. Dute, also one of my students, he has also worked on agriculture, a very nice work he has produced and advanced methodology he has used. Now, this seminar is being organized in collaboration with the Prabhab by the Chogle College, Margao, Goa. And from there, Dr. Anand Sawant, who is also going to address this meeting in the form of as a keynote address. So, Dr. Sawant, it would be very nice to listen to you in fact. So Dr. S.P. Dute, organizing secretary, Dr. A.N. Dadas, coordinator, IQAC, Dehivadi College, Dr. Shela Ghanti, officiating principal, Prabha Bhai College, Chogle, Prabha Bhai Chogle College, Marga, Goa, Dr. Surinder, Thakur Desai, head department of geography, Gugate, Jaglekar College, Ratnagiri, Dr. Sachin Tendulkar, chief executive officer, Mineral Foundation, Goa. All these are the people, those who are going to have a discourse on this topic. And I feel that even other people, staffs and other staff, teaching staff, non-teaching staff, and the student friends, they are participating in this very important seminar. So the seminar, the topic which you have chosen, Dr. Gayakwad and organizing secretary and others and principal, Dr. B.S. Balwant, this is really very suitable and it is a need of the hour to look into the problems of areas where the water stress is being felt. So therefore, sustainable development of rainwater harvesting and artificial groundwater recharge in India. Today, it is being organized and it's really very appealing and suitable topic which you have selected for this webinar. Now, looking into the problem that there are in Maharashtra itself, there are various areas which have been selected and identified for recharging, the water recharging. Water stress, because water stress is being felt at different parts of the country due to increasing demand resulting from the population explosion and food security. Now there is a need of water for food industry and domestic use, in fact. So it has exceeded the natural recharge. Natural recharge also takes place. But the thing is that we are consuming and making use of groundwater more than the natural recharge. Therefore, there is a need of artificial recharge by rainwater harvesting at different areas. So groundwater has increased exponentially. So it has increased the natural recharge. Areas of artificial recharge have been identified based on post-monsoon water level. Focus need to be paid to study water-stressed areas, and it needs to be managed to be artificially recharged by harvesting rainwater. Now, this, if we take into consideration in Maharashtra itself, I will take 2-3 minutes more. In Maharashtra is having the area 3,07,715 kilometer area, which is identified for artificial recharging. That is 1,23,884 square kilometer. And you may be surprised as volume of unsaturated zone, that is 4,33,654 MCF. Available subsurface for artificial recharge, that is 13,621 MCF. Water required for recharge, that is 18,081 MCF. So this is what actually condition. Looking, coming down to Sangli, this district itself, where the seminar at Dehivadi College, Dehivadi, is being organized. If we look at the position of the Sangli in this respect, area of Sangli, area of district, Sangli district is 8,572 square kilometer. Area which is identified for artificial this recharge, that is 3,124 square kilometer. Volume of unsaturated zone, that is 11,815 MCF. Available subsurface space for artificial recharge, that is 236 MCF. Water required for recharge in Sangli district, that is 315 MCF. So this is what, and surplus available for recharge. Surplus available for recharge, that is 77 MCF only. So this is what actually the position of Maharashtra state and the Sangli, where this seminar is conducted, because eastern part of Sangli, their rainfall is less. And there is a need of recharging, artificial water recharging. And whatever the rain is being received, that each drop of rain needs to be fully utilized and saved and used for the recharge purpose. Therefore, now this is, I tell you one example in this respect where you know it very well, not only in Maharashtra, in India, and in the world whole. Raleigh-Gunj city is well known for its rain water harvesting. There Anna Hazare, after getting retired from this military service as a driver, and he felt that his people, particularly from his village, migrating to other villages, and people using tobacco and having liquor. So that was the problem. And people, they are not having a way, the water for their crops or vegetables. So then he started a percolation tank on the top of the village, just a little above. Then the gabbing structure, Kolhapur type structure, various types of these ones he has constructed, and each drop of water, the rain received at Raligan city is hardly 500 millimeter. So that you can imagine that in such a dry area, the each water each drop of water of rain has been harvested, saved, and it is used for recharging the groundwater. And you might have seen that the village has been not only turned into flourished, that has flourished to very green belt, and people have now come back and the production is enough. But there are certain rules which they have to follow in the village, that they don't have to cut the trees, they don't have to grow the sugarcane, because sugarcane uses more than 80% of the irrigation, so that we can make use of this 80% water for other crops. Therein we can have enough good grains, vegetables, and other requirements from the field. Therefore, this is how he has turned the poverty-stricken village into a sustainable development and sustainable water, this rainwater harvesting. This is the prime example from Maharashtra, from Pune, from Maharashtra itself, Raligan city. And this model was followed by various other villages and other countries also for the development, for harvesting the rainwater. So I feel that this is the way that to make our society very much aware of each drop of this water harvesting, and at local level, at household level, at village level, or city level, especially in urban areas where the consumption is very high in the domestic and industrial areas. Therefore, I feel that we can make use and bring the people towards this attention, and people should be aware of not exploiting the water or over-exploitation. That has to be discussed. And I am very much proud that you have organized this seminar on this topic, particularly that's groundwater harvesting artificially and rainwater, that is through rainwater or whatever the other sources we have, so that it would not be useful only that village, but the surrounding area of that village will also get benefited, and their income and will increase, and poverty will certainly decrease, and we will move towards the sustainable development. And if each village will done, and this, I think entire Maharashtra with more than 43,000 villages will flourish like anything, along with the country where other villages also feeling the stress. So this is the way how the society development will take place, by harvesting, by this rainwater and other artificial ways of saving our water and groundwater recharge. I think that there are people, this Anand Sawant and this Surendra Thakur Desai, Sachin Tendulkar, and maybe some other people will talk on this and will make the people aware of and will bring a contribution, and they will certainly do the contribution towards the academic development and identify the areas, at the end, I will feel that that this webinar will come out with a solution that how the stressed Butterstead areas can be artificially recharged, and we can have enough water in those areas to meet our needs, agriculture, the industry, or some other uses. With this, we will certainly go ahead, and we will develop, and we will also help others to develop. And I feel this is the real way how the society can be developed, and each individual has to participate in this process of sustainable development by harvesting rainwater or some other ways of our needs, in fact. So the groundwater has to be recharged. So I am very much thankful for getting me joined this webinar, Dr. Gaikwad, Dr. Dute, Dr. B.S. Balwant, Savant Balwant, and other staff of the college. I am very much thankful to all of you, and I am very proud of that seminar organized, and will come out with certain influences for the society development. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable talk. Then I request to our acting principal, Dr. B.S. Balwant, sir, for his presidential talk.
Dute, sir. हॅलो
काय बोला सर, येतोय आवाज?
हा, माझा आवाज येतोय ना तुमच्यापर्यंत?
येतोय. व्हिडिओ चालू करा तुमचा.
ओके,
व्हिडिओ चालू करा. व्हिडिओ
दहिवडी कॉलेज
सर, व्हिडिओ चालू करा. हॅलो हॅलो
बळवंत सर,
त्यांना सांगा कुठून करायचे. यू टेल हिम द मेथड. इन फॅक्ट ही मस्ट बी नोईंग बट माइट बी फॉरगॉटन. जस्ट आस्क हिम टू हाऊ टू डू दिस. इन फॅक्ट
आय थिंक ही इज ऑफलाईन.
हा, ही इज ऑफलाईन बिकॉज ही इज नॉट पुटिंग. बट
ओके ओके, नो प्रॉब्लेम. वन मिनिट में ज्वाइन हो जाएंगे. वो तो रोज वेबिनार वगैरह होता है, लेकिन
स्टार्टिंग टू हेल्प हिम आउट देयर इटसेल्फ. ही इज सिटिंग इन द कॉलेज इटसेल्फ.
हां, यस सर, यस.
आई जस्ट आस्क समबडी टू हेल्प हिम आउट सो दैट एवरीबॉडी कैन लिसन टू हिम.
यस सर,
यस.
हॅलो.
हा बोला सर, आता
येतोय.
दहिवडी कॉलेज, दहिवडी पार्वतीबाई चौगुले कॉलेज गोवा यांच्या संयुक्त विद्यमाने आज राष्ट्रीय वेबिनारच्या निमित्तानं जॉईन झालेले या वेबिनारचे प्रमुख पाहुणे माननीय डॉक्टर के सी रमोत्रा सर या कार्यक्रमामध्ये वेगवेगळ्या सत्रामध्ये मार्गदर्शन करणारे जे प्रमुख पारदर्शक आहेत त्यामध्ये माननीय डॉक्टर एन एन सावंत सर, माननीय डॉक्टर एस डी शिंदे सर, महाविद्यालयातील आय पी सी सेलचे कोऑर्डिनेटर प्राध्यापक डॉक्टर धुमस सर, भूगोल विभागाचे विभाग प्रमुख
सर.
सर आवाज,
माइक चालू करा सर. माइक आवाज येत नाही.
बळवंत सर आवाज येत नाही.
प्राध्यापक सोमेन सर. हॅलो बोलते सर, आवाज येतोय का?
येतोय, बोला. आता येतोय.
येतोय ना?
येतोय.
दिवटे सर, आज महाविद्यालयामध्ये आयोजित केलेले हे जे नॅशनल वेबिनार आहे या वेबिनारचा विषय अतिशय उपयुक्त आणि काळाची गरज ओळखून त्याचं नियोजन कसं करावं या विषयावर हे वेबिनार आज संपन्न होत आहे. या वेबिनारच्या निमित्तानं ऑनलाईन जॉईन झालेले प्रमुख पाहुणे रमोतराज सर यांचं मी महाविद्यालयाच्या वतीनं आणि भूगोल विभागाच्या वतीनं मनपूर्वक स्वागत करतो. हे वेबिनार 4 सत्रांमध्ये संपन्न होईल. आपणा सर्वांना माहीत आहे की जगावर आणि भारतावर वेगवेगळ्या प्रकारच्या आपत्ती या येत आहेत आणि त्यामधली दुष्काळाची आपत्ती ही या ड्रॉटपूर्ण एरियामध्ये राहणाऱ्या सर्वच महाविद्यालयातील प्राध्यापक विद्यार्थी आणि लोकांना परिचित आहे. तेव्हा हा एक वेगळा विषय घेऊन भूगोल विभागानं अतिशय सुंदर या वेबिनारचं आयोजन केलेलं आहे. या वेबिनारच्या माध्यमामधून ऑनलाईन जॉईन होणाऱ्या सर्व भूगोलाचा अभ्यास करणाऱ्या विद्यार्थी आणि प्राध्यापक बंधू भगिनींना निश्चितपणे याचा फायदा होईल अशी आशा मला वाटते. मी या निमित्तानं महाविद्यालयाच्या वतीनं आपणा सर्वांना मनपूर्वक शुभेच्छा देतो आणि या ठिकाणी थांबतो. धन्यवाद सर. हॅलो.
हा
ओके सर. ओके थँक्यू सर.
थँक्यू फॉर सर फॉर युअर व्हॅल्युएबल प्रेझेंटेशन गायडन्स. देन आय थँकफुल टू प्रोफेसर डॉक्टर के सी रमोत्रा टू प्रेझेंट दिस वेबिनार अँड गिव अ व्हॅल्युएबल टॉक ऑन द थीम. देन आय ऑल्सो थँकफुल टू अवर प्रिन्सिपल हू प्रमोट अस for the arranging the different activities in our college, Dr. B.S. Balwan sir. I also thankful to Professor Dr. N.M. Sawan sir, Professor Dr. S.D. Shinde sir, Dr. Gaikwad sir, Dr. Tendulkar sir, Dr. Thakur Desai sir, and all participants who are present in this inaugural function. I again thankful to all and request to Dr. VP Gaikwad sir to introduce the keynote speaker of this webinar.
Thank you sir. Today's keynote speaker Professor Dr. N.N. Sawan sir from former principal and हेड डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ ज्योग्राफी पार्वतीबाई चौगुले कॉलेज मडगाव गोवा. खरं तर सगळ्यात हसतमुख आणि सगळ्याच गोष्टींचं खूप मनपूर्वक स्वागत करणारे असे आमचे हे सिनियर मित्र आहेत की ते डॉक्टर सावन सर हे नेहमीच वेगवेगळ्या ऍक्टिव्हिटी घेत असताना आम्हाला त्या कशा घ्याव्यात, वर्कशॉप कसं घ्यावं किंवा त्यामध्ये मुलांचा सहभाग कसा घ्यावा, फॅकल्टीला कशाची गरज आहे याचं मार्गदर्शन ते करत असतात. 2018 पासून आम्ही दरवर्षी कमीत कमी 1 ते 2 ऍक्टिव्हिटी राबवत असतो. ह्या कोरोनाच्या महामारीमध्ये सुद्धा आपल्याला ही ऍक्टिव्हिटी घ्यायला पाहिजे असा आग्रह आमच्या दोघांचाही होता आणि त्यामुळे ऑनलाईन वेबिनारचं आम्ही नियोजन केलं. सरांच्या बाबतीमध्ये सरांचं जे कॉलेज आहे ते आपल्याला माहित आहे की ज्योग्राफी डिपार्टमेंट हे तिथलं खूप डेव्हलप अशा प्रकारचं डिपार्टमेंट आहे. सरांच्यामुळं तिथं वेगवेगळे कोर्स राबवले जातात. स्किल डेव्हलपमेंट कोर्स असतील, GIS जिओइन्फॉर्मॅटिक्सचा कोर्स असेल, समर ट्रेनिंग कोर्स असतील, तर हे खूप मोठ्या प्रमाणात राबवले जातात. आणि भूगोल विषयामध्ये त्यांनी ह्या नवीन ज्या कन्सेप्ट येत आहेत ते सांगण्याचा प्रयत्न सर्व देशभरातील आपल्या ज्योग्राफरला करत असतात. तर अशा पद्धतीनं त्याचबरोबर ते स्वतः गाईड आहेत. त्यांचे रिसर्च पेपर जे आहेत ते नॅशनल इंटरनॅशनल लेवलला पब्लिश आहेत. त्याचबरोबर गोवा ज्योग्राफर हे जे खूप चांगलं जर्नल आहे त्याचे सुद्धा ते प्रमुख आहेत. आणि अनेक म्हणजे फक्त पॉप्युलेशन, सोशल ज्योग्राफी किंवा टुरिझम असं नाही, तर ऍग्रीकल्चर असेल किंवा हे नवीन कन्सेप्ट मधल्या अनेक विषयांना ते सतत मार्गदर्शन करत असतात. असे सगळ्यात महत्वाचं त्यांनी हे वेबिनार घेण्यासाठी परवानगी दिली. मग रिसर्च पर्सन ठरवणे किंवा विषय निवडणे, प्रोग्राम शेड्यूल तयार करणे, त्यामध्ये सरांचा रोज आमचा फोन असायचा. खूप सारांनी मदत केली आणि ह्या विषयामधलं जी सुरुवात आहे, सुरुवातीला ती कन्सेप्ट सांगण्याचं त्यांनी कबूल केलं, त्याबद्दल मी आमच्या महाविद्यालयातर्फे सरांना खूप धन्यवाद देतो. आणि सरांना विनंती करतो की आपलं जे की नोट्स स्पीच आहे ते आपण प्रेझेंट करावं अशी सरांना विनंती करतो. धन्यवाद.
थँक्यू डॉक्टर गायकवाड. आय एम द को होस्ट ऑफ दिस वन डे नॅशनल सेमिनार. So it gives me immense pleasure on behalf of Dahivadi College and Parvatibai Chowale College to welcome each and everyone for this one day national webinar. Sagranla namaskar ani mi sagranla swagat karto. It's very important that in the field of academics we start thinking in a different way. I am the keynote speaker and therefore my role is very well defined. मला एक ओव्हरव्ह्यू द्यायला लागेल की व्हॉट इज टू बी लुक्ड ॲट इन द कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ इंडिया. अँड देअरफोर इट्स अ प्लेजर टू स्पीक समथिंग विच हॅज टू बी व्हेरी रिलेव्हंट मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टंटली. अँड सेकंड मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टंट थिंग इज दॅट हाऊ डू वी मेक इट मोर ॲप्लिकेबल. मी माझं प्रेझेंटेशन विल मूव्ह विथ अ पॉवर पॉईंट. गायकवाड सरांशी बोललो. They have been very clear telling me that yes, I should speak about 10 to 15 minutes. And it's very valid because nowadays people have a very less attention span and therefore we would speak. So with the permission of the principal of Dahivadi College and permission of the chief guest and of course the organizers, I start my presentation. So dear friends, today we are going to discuss on sustainable development of rainwater harvesting and artificial groundwater recharge. The very question that starts, which is very relevant, is India deficit or surplus of rainfall? Bharatamadhi paus padto ani paus kami ahe ka jaasta, and this is a very debatable question. As geographers apan spatio temporal rainfall characteristics vachto. But do we think that what happens to this rain? And if you look at a very cursory glance, manje ek map pahila, tar apan India la teen divisions madhi clear cut karu shakto. One, which is a zone of surplus rainwater, which is again, second, a moderate rainfall, and there is a zone of water scarcity. And something very interesting is that there is Parvatibai Chowale College, which is located in rain area where there is surplus rain. And there is Dahivadi College, which is a zone which is called the rain shadow zone, or which also calls the drought prone area. And therefore, you can see a travel from the coast towards the Western Ghats and beyond the Western Ghats. But prashna asa ahe ki Goa madhi surplus water ahe ka nahi. And let me tell you, I'm sure Sachin Tendulkar sir will tell much more better. There are certain villages in Goa also where there is scarcity of water. So therefore, today's discussion is very relevant and we need to understand what are the practices that are practiced all over the country and maybe what can be best suited for the local area. A very good news that came in Al Jazeera in 2019. 11,000 mm rainfall hoto Chirapunji, and of course now you can call as Mausim Gram. But even from the month of November till month of April, this region suffers from water scarcity. Why? And yacha uttar ekach ahe, because they do not practice rain water harvesting, or they do not have rain harvesting. So prashna, the question that we started is that, is India surplus or deficit of water? And the answer to this is that we receive 4 billion cubic meters of rainfall and we only require about 3,000. That means it's almost 1,000 surplus water ahe aplyakade. Dukhachi gosht hi hai ki fakt 8% apan te pani vapartho and baki sagla samudrala jate. And Goa is not an exception that very, very clearly, we are not able to use rainwater most advisably and rationally. In urban areas, sagayat white kaya hai, 80% of water just goes in the drains, maybe through sewage and anything, only 20% is somewhere we used. So the point is not ki whether India is having surplus water or deficit water. Point ite ye ek fakta hai ki, do we have the best practices of rainwater harvesting and groundwater recharge? And therefore, mala vatte ki this topic is such a relevant, we as being academicians, and maybe in the concluding remarks, what can education institutes do is what I'm going to speak on. What is rainwater harvesting and groundwater recharge? Rainwater harvesting, paus padto, jamnivarti eto, vahun jato, samudra lagela, that means there is nothing, we have not done any harvesting. Samja tela thambola. Maybe if you store in some means, then it becomes harvesting. And if you allow it to get into the water and percolation, then it becomes a groundwater recharge. Apan geography madhi shabd vaparto, percolation, porous, imporous, aquifers. These sagle shabd are very important when we think of recharge groundwaters. Asa nahi ki today we are thinking of groundwater. Aur asa nahi hai ki there is a shortage of water today. Hi purvi pan hota. And there were various traditional methods that we used. But today the consciousness is very much, and therefore we are talking about traditional methods and modern methods. Since the theme is related to India, I will just take you for a few slides of different practices that are practiced in whole of India. Rajasthan, and jo apan Rajasthan munto arid region, and apan je teen bhag ke liye, I'm going to speak on that particular theme. Rajasthan madhe scarcity of water hai, how do they manage? And there are different ways. Apan Marathi madhe bauris munto, in Rajasthan it's called bauris. Then tanks, tankas, and kuds. Tankas is something which is very amazing. Manje, Rajasthan is always known for magnificent forts. But also Rajasthan is known for magnificent conservation and harvesting of water. And tankas is something step like wells. And it's a ashera sagrat ghost. Manje, yachyamadhi kaya hai, don ahet. One is the pond or a tank or you can say a lake-like feature. Or in modern ways, we call a swimming pool. And Techa Bazula, there is a well also. So for the tank, water is used for the public, for maybe bathing and many other things. And the well Bazula Aste, which is separate, is used for drinking water. So you see how the ancient methods of conservation of water. The whole tank area is so wide that there is a lot of water that seeps in and the catchment area is much bigger. At a very small level, jite people are very limited, tankas are something which is very there. The word tankas is like a tanki. Apan Marathi madhe taki munto tela. But more important, apan ya diagram madhe pahila, tar very important, it is covered so that there is no evaporation. Apan evapotranspiration cha badal khup sa bolto kadhi kadhi geography madhi. So you conserve the water by allowing not to evaporate. So you are controlling. And second thing, you have a filter by putting a zigzag movements all around the well, and so that water seeps in and you get a safe drinking water. Kud cha baddal mein aata bolnar nahi, because I'm going to mention this when I'm going to talk about Tamil Nadu, and which is very similar features that we have. But in even in surplus area, and we give an example of Mausimgram Chiramchunji, Arunachal Pradesh is a hilly area, which is mountainous area, rivers flow there, a lot of surplus water. But even the ancient tribes used a certain technique of water. Manje he scene je apan pahato is not different than what is in Goa. Apan Goa madhi pan we are very discussing something called Khazan lands. But here it's a very mixed culture of agriculture and pisciculture, manje fish. And the very fact is that in the upper stream water is blocked and channelized through using bamboos, because that's the local resource. And then you water budget it as per the requirement of the of the fields. The fields are very small, there are channels and everything. So what you see is that there is a mixed match of water budgeting as well as pisciculture, fish catching. Now the organic that comes becomes a good fish food for the fish, and that is how there is a subsistence, or what we call as sustainable development of the local economy. Himalayas. At the Himalayas, of course, there is two things, rains as well as the melting of the glaciers, and therefore they have to adopt a different ways. The most important thing is that apart from the water, there is more important of disasters, landslides, water, movement and many other things. And therefore, they have to have a different structures which will not only just talk about erosion, sheet erosion, many other things, but again, kasa apan water control karun. Afforestation has been one of the most successful methods, but even construction, something which will allow them the water to filter. In Jammu and Himachal, a very important practice is kul. Or kula also it is called as nala, just the way nala is called. Kula also is there, where in the upper stream, you along the river, you create a stream and then give it to the waters so that the excess water is then channelized. And that is how there has been traditional methods. Maharashtra has been a great example. And what I like about Maharashtra is the experiments that farmers do. It is at community level, at individual level. Aapla chief guest ni very great example of Rail Siddhi Dila. So I'm going to give about, we all know this Hivri Bazar village. And what is very important is that there are 54 millionaires in this village. आपण जेव्हा गावाचा विचार करतो आपण फक्त गरिबी दुष्काळ ह्याच्याबद्दल विचार करतो बट पोपटराव पवार हु गॉट पद्मश्री इन 2020 ही ट्रान्सफॉर्म द ड्राउन प्रोन विलेज इन टू अ ग्रीन मॉडल विलेज देर वॉज अ इंटरव्ह्यू दिस संडे ऑन एअर अँड आय वॉज लिस्निंग टू हिम अँड वॉट ही वॉज व्हेरी क्लिअरली सेड वी हॅव बीन इन्स्ट्रुमेंटल बिकॉज ऑफ द कम्युनिटी इनिशिएटिव्ह आणि आपण एक पिक्चर इथे पाहतो ऑन द लेफ्ट साईड a dry area where community got involved and you today see the present landscape which is completely transformed. Today, this village also is corona free. But what is important here, fakta apan mhatla tar in his interview, he said that we changed the crop pattern. Water conserve karaycha hai, tar wo crop pattern pan badlala paije. Sugarcane is a crop of Maharashtra and therefore it's a very high consuming water and there are a lot of problems of salinity and many other things. But here, water budgeting for the crop kelatini. So you have soya, you have bajra, you have vegetables which will require lesser water requirement but more crop productivity, and therefore jo drought pan area asun pan they be able to do a good water budgeting and utilization to maximize agricultural productivity and sustainable development. So these are great examples aplyala je miltat all over the country apan east west north south la gelo and that is what we have realized this aaj there is lot of awareness there is scientific research that takes place there is engineering geographers unfortunately apan fakt bolto only in the terms of theoretical way aaj agar aplya mulanla sangitla can you develop a watershed planning I would doubt in this context. We only talk about physiography and geomorphology, but unfortunately, we'll not able to talk about how do we crop this. And therefore, if you read through the literature, there are various methods. Manje gali plug sahet, sunken ponds sahet, nala band sahet, apan bandaras pan manto, check dam sahet, gay band sahet. And each one has a value system that means in Prakash. Like for example, first order streams la we normally try to have a gully plugs je apan picture madhe bagto and when it goes to maybe little higher voluminous movement of water gabions ani mothe varte check dams again here you see on this picture very nicely sunken dams which can be put across everywhere and water recharge apan jeva apan ground water recharge mhantoy all these methods are going to be a very useful methods for a ground water recharge there are artificial means also and Maharashtra has again experimented this of creating artificial tanks where you pour water and then make it into a sheet and then it's a very nice way of conserving the rain water as well as the ground water at individual levels apan je pictures bagto we have slopes flat roofs and you have sloping roofs but very important that whether this water is been either stored in storage tanks it can be at overhead storage tanks or at the ground and then pumped up again or ground madhi the aquifer madhi ghalun again you can recharge it or you can just leave it in the well which is there and therefore how it takes place but again there are now lot of other discussions that are happening all over the country of encouraging maybe in forested area maybe open areas like having soak pits trenches and artificial ponds which will allow the water to seep in and it can be of great utility because what is more important, upon Maharashtra madhi khup sar bagto ki the groundwater is going down because of surplus extraction of water. So when we talk about groundwater recharge, it is input versus output. Agar input kami asla and output jaast asla, definitely the groundwater level is going to go down. The more important thing is that can we make some ways in which groundwater recharge can be more and therefore groundwater level will increase over a period of time. And that is what something which we need to do. Apart from that requirement, unfortunately, in India, we have never been able to use what is the water. It is a variation. From individual's water to 50 liter to maybe even going to 500 liters per day. Hotels use water to almost 750 liters per day per person in an executive hotel. So when we look at these examples, what is Government of India doing? And Government of India started with something called Jal Shakti Abhiyan. And if we have five objectives, so very clearly upon Bhakto, there is water conservation and rainwater harvesting, renovation of traditional and water bodies, reuse of water and recharging, watershed development, and intensive afforestation. And that is something and water sanitation. Kutetari, I have all discussed this because when I said in urban areas, sewage, 80% of water is just goes for a waste and only 20%. But something which is important that there is a mapping that is done. And I think as a geographer, aplyala he ek very important question hai, which areas are under stress? And you can very clearly said red colors shows very stressed areas. And you can see it is all the rain shadow areas and drought prone areas. And more important, Tamil Nadu. Because very clearly it does not receive regular rain from the southwest monsoons, but it during monsoons, and maybe you receive or not receive. Again, apply statistics pahila tar monsoons manne 80% rainfall melto ani fakta 20% is from the retreating monsoons, and therefore Tamil Nadu has made a lot of efforts in this context. So what has Tamil Nadu done? Tamil Nadu first and foremost has taken a legal initiative that all societies in urban areas will have some watershed water harvesting initiatives. And let me tell you, this has been very clearly increased in the groundwater level. We had just discussed this and here upon pahila. And when I was talking about Maharashtra, about Rajasthan, jithe kud cha baddal bolos do, so this is like a open well where you have inlets. And in Madi well, you can see this diagram. So you take water from all the surrounding areas and then in the central area where the water seeps in, and it then that's how the groundwater recharge takes place. And this is a success story of Tamil Nadu. I remember Chennai Madhi there were a few years back, tremendous water scarcity problems. But our Chennai does not, and that is the way it has taken place. Because of limitation of time, me kai sagale examples nahi deu shaknar, but I have been able to give an certain overview of what practices have been across India in rainwater harvesting and groundwater recharge. Fakt the government can do it or can individuals do it? And I would say that yes, individuals also can do it. In Maharashtra, especially in drought prone area, Amir Khan and his wife, after his TV serial of Satya Mein Jayate, he started something called Pani Foundation in 2016. And this is something which is something where voluntary people come and help to develop their village community and conserve water. And here diagram apan pahato ite ki previously it was dry. After initiating of Pani, creation of community development, things have changed. So here, very clearly, upon what we have realized, it is just not government. It is also initiative taken by community, by NGOs, and by individual people like Anna Hazare or Poppat Rao, which shows that things can change for a better India in terms of water conservation and part of it. I'm going to finish this by just 1 minute. We as educationists have to understand that very clearly that water budgeting is something which we all need to understand. Maharashtra madhi jo problem zala hai, yeah, if you take in Punjab, surplus water, which has actually affected the water quality, increasing salinity, lands not been used for agricultural efficiency. Okay, is a great example of one thing which we need to understand. Water budgeting, not only on rainfall concept, but also from the context of the crop cultivation pattern. Upon geographers, we talk about crop combination and best suitabilities and all these things. But I think somewhere, he a practical approach is a very, very important thing. And the second thing is, I personally feel that water recycle and water usage. Israel has shown to the whole world that they use about 82% reuse their water. म्हणजे जवळजवळ 80% जे पाणी त्यांनी वापरतात परत वापरतात अँड दॅट इज हाऊ दे हॅव बीन एबल टू डेव्हलप अ सक्सेसफुल मॉडेल. सो शेवटी वॉट कम्स इज दॅट इन अ कॅस्केडिंग इफेक्ट सरकार आहे एक साईडला, एकला देर इज अ इंडिव्हिज्युअल्स, देर इज ऑल्सो एनजीओज लाईक पाणी फाउंडेशन. वॉट इज द अल्टिमेट गोल ऑफ एज्युकेशनल इन्स्टिट्यूट्स? अँड ॲट दिस पॉईंट ऑफ टाईम मला एकतर फक्त एवढंच म्हणायचं की all colleges have a big geographical area. I'm sure every college has about 4 acres, 5 acres. Have we observed and have we given to our students task, what is the surface runoff and how much water can be conserved at the institutional level? And I think apan fakta nag cha baddal point cha baddal vichar karne cha baddal, can we do something called as community outreach in terms of part of it? Point number one. And point number two, which I also want to say, is that can we develop small models on the campus of water, artificial recharge, artificial harvesting and everything, and a community like education karun, and that could be a great way of doing this. And the third thing, aajkal chi mula are very good in creating videos and many other things. And if we can create videos and then circulate amongst the community for awareness, I think as an educationist, we have a greater role to do. So, to conclude, the map, as a geographer, म्हणजे geographer ला map च्या विना काही बोलायला होत नाही, you could see that we have a high and extremely high water stress, 54% of the India's camp. Can we say that yes, in next 10 years, this figure goes less than 50%, which is a great commendable part. And I'm sure it is not just the government and NGO, but I would say you and we can do it. Thank you so much for this opportunity for me to give the keynote address. Thank you so much, and I close down.
Thank you, sir, for a nice and valuable presentation. Then I request to chairperson of this session, Professor Dr. S. D. Shinde, please guide us.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, first of all,
yes. I must congratulate Rayat Shikshan Samstha's Dahivadi College, Dahivadi, my friend Dr. Vijay Gaikwad, Principal Balwan sir, and chief guest of this national webinar, my teacher Professor Ramotra sir, and keynote speaker my friend Professor Nandkumar Sawan sir from Goa. Really, Sawan sir has very systematically and pinpoint presented whole scenario of this rainwater harvesting, water management.
What happened? Hello?
Shinde sir, aawaz yet nahi.
Education is for student, teacher, we can contribute that creating awareness among this water literacy, water budgeting and need of this particular rainwater harvesting. मी परत एकदा मनापासून सरांना अभिनंदन देतो की 5 जून पर्यावरण दिनाच्या निमित्तानं सध्याची जी आपली सगळ्यात महत्वाची गरज आहे ती म्हणजे पाणी, पाण्याचं व्यवस्थापन. पाणी कमी असेल तरी प्रॉब्लेम आहेत आणि जास्त असेल तरी खूप प्रॉब्लेम आहेत. आणि सरांनी खूप चांगल्या पद्धतीने सांगितलं रियूज अँड रिसायकल ऑफ वॉटर. आणि मला वाटतं शिवाजी विद्यापीठानं भूजल विकास यंत्रणा महाराष्ट्र राज्य यांच्या संयुक्त विद्यापीठानं हा कार्यक्रम सुरू केलाय. उद्या ज्योग्राफी डिपार्टमेंट शिवाजी विद्यापीठ कोल्हापूर आणि भूजल विकास यंत्रणा महाराष्ट्र राज्य यांच्या संयुक्त विद्यमाने महाराष्ट्रातील जे क्रिटिकल जिल्हे आहेत ज्यांची ग्राउंड वॉटर लेवल खूपच कमी आहे आणि त्याच्यात सरफेस रेन वॉटर हार्वेस्टिंग कलेक्शन त्याच्याबद्दल आणि एकंदरीत वॉटर मॅनेजमेंट बद्दल खूप मोठा कार्यक्रम वर्षभरासाठी आपण घेतलेला आहे. त्याचं उद्या मला वाटतं 3 वाजता ट्रेनिंग त्याच्याबद्दल यशदा जी ट्रेनिंग पुरवते. तर आपले जे ज्योग्राफीचे विद्यार्थी असतील एनएसएसचे विद्यार्थी असतील तर त्यांचा असा एक वर्षभरासाठीचा कार्यक्रम आहे. मी परत एकदा कारण हा ऑनलाईन प्लॅटफॉर्म आहे देर इज अ व्हेरी लिमिटेड टाइम आय मस्ट कॉंग्रॅच्युलेट टू प्रोफेसर नंदकुमार सावंत अँड विजय गायकवाड फॉर धिस ब्युटिफुल वेबिनार अँड सर डिस्कस ऑल दीज पर्टिक्युलर थिंग्स वी शुड कंटिन्यू दीज पर्टिक्युलर सजेशन्स अँड वन्स अगेन थँक्यू व्हेरी मच टू द ऑर्गनायझर्स इस्पेशली विजय गायकवाड सर अँड बळवंत सर. थँक्यू सर. थँक्यू व्हेरी मच.
थँक्यू सर. देन आय रिक्वेस्ट टू Mr. D.G. Gorad to propose a vote of thanks for this session. Gorad sir.
हा सर आवाज येतोय का माझा?
येतोय आवाज येतोय.
ओके सर. हा या आजच्या कार्यक्रमाचे केनोट स्पीकर डॉक्टर एन एन सावंत साहेब हेड डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ ज्योग्राफी पार्वतीबाई चौगुली कॉलेज मडगाव गोवा यांनी अतिशय उपयुक्त अशी ग्राउंड वॉटर च्या संदर्भात वॉटर हार्वेस्टिंग अतिशय उपयुक्त अशी इन्फॉर्मेशन आपल्याला सगळ्यांना दिली. मी आपल्या महाविद्यालयाच्या वतीने त्यांचा खूप आभार आहे. त्याचबरोबर आज या ठिकाणी डॉक्टर एस टी शिंदे सर हेड डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ ज्योग्राफी युनिव्हर्सिटी कोल्हापूर चेअरमन बोर्ड ऑफ स्टडी ज्योग्राफी अँड जिओलॉजी शिवाजी युनिव्हर्सिटी कोल्हापूर यांनी आपल्याला या ठिकाणी मार्गदर्शन केलं. मी त्यांचाही आपल्या महाविद्यालयाच्या वतीनं व भूगोल विभागाच्या वतीने आभारी आहे. त्याचबरोबर या कार्यक्रमासाठी जे सर्वांनी सहभाग नोंदवला त्या सर्वांचा मी महाविद्यालयाच्या वतीने खूप आभारी आहे. धन्यवाद सर.
थँक्यू सर. ओके सावंत सर. सावंत सर शेअरिंग तुमचं स्टॉप करता का प्लीज? हॅलो
स्क्रीन शेअर स्टॉप करा सावंत सर.
स्क्रीन शेअर स्टॉप करा सर. हॅलो
सावंत डॉक्टर सावंत सर आवाज येतोय का?
सर
हॅलो
मी स्टॉप करतो. हा झाला.
हा झाला झाला. ओके ओके थँक्यू सर. देन लेट अस स्टार्ट द फर्स्ट सेशन ऑफ दिस वेबिनार अँड आय रिक्वेस्ट टू डॉक्टर अनिल येडगे टू इंट्रोड्यूस द रिसोर्स पर्सन of this first session. Dr. Anil Edge. Sir, video chalu kara.
Sir, aiku yeto ka?
Aawaz thoda sa kami yetoy, aawaz vadva ani video chalu kara.
Sir, aiku yeto.
Ha yetoy aawaz bola sir.
आजच्या कार्यक्रमाचे
येडगे सर व्हिडिओ चालू करा. व्हिडिओ
हो चालू केला सर.
व्हिडिओ बंद आहे. व्हिडिओ
आपल्या या पहिल्या सेशन सर चालू केला व्हिडिओ.
हा असू द्या सर. सुरू ठेवा सुरू ठेवा.
बोला.
आपल्या या पहिल्या सेशनचे रिसोर्स पर्सन डॉक्टर सुरेंद्र ठाकूर देसाई सर हे डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ ज्योग्राफी गोपी जोगळेकर कॉलेज याचे हेड आहेत. सरांनी जवळपास 25 वर्ष टीचिंग मध्ये काम केलेलं आहे. सरांनी केमिस्ट्री पुणे युनिव्हर्सिटी मध्ये केलेलं. सरांचं जे स्पेशलायझेशन आहे रिसर्च ते कोस्टल जिओमॉर्फोलॉजी आणि इन्व्हायरमेंटल ज्योग्राफी मध्ये आहे. सरांना 2 युनिव्हर्सिटीची गाईडशिप पण आहे. युनिव्हर्सिटी ऑफ मुंबई आणि टिळक महाराष्ट्र विद्यापीठ. सरांच्या अंडर ऐंशी मुलांना पीएचडी एमफिल अवॉर्ड झालेले आहे आणि चार मुलं सरांच्या अंडर पीएचडी करत आहेत आणि एकाला अवॉर्ड मिळालेले आहे. सरांचं जे पब्लिफिकेशन जे वर्क आहे ते सरांनी 9 रिसर्च पेपर पब्लिश केलेले आहेत, 2 बुक चॅप्टर झालेले आहेत, 1 सरांचं बुक 33 आर्टिकल पब्लिकेशनला पब्लिश केलेले आहेत. सरांनी 7 रिसर्च प्रोजेक्ट सबमिट केलेले आहेत एजन्सीमध्ये, युजीसीच्या अंडर काही पेपर रिसर्च प्रोजेक्ट सबमिट केलेले आहेत, काही मुंबई युनिव्हर्सिटीच्या अंडर केलेले आहेत, काही कोकण डेव्हलपमेंट बोर्ड, मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ ऍग्रिकल्चर, गव्हर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया यांच्या अंडर सुद्धा सरांनी असे वेगवेगळे टोटल 7 रिसर्च प्रोजेक्ट सबमिट केलेले आहेत. सरांना काही वेगवेगळ्या संस्थेमार्फत अवॉर्ड पण मिळालेले आहेत. बेस्ट रिसर्च पेपर अवॉर्ड ऍट नॅशनल लेवल सेमिनार होल्ड MS युनिव्हर्सिटी तिरुनवेली तामिळनाडू इथे 2004 अवॉर्ड मिळालेला आहे. त्यानंतर सरांना गुणवान शिक्षक पुरस्कार हा लॉयन्स क्लब रत्नागिरी मार्फत 2006 दिलेला आहे. त्यानंतर लेट बाबूराव जोशी आदर्श शिक्षक पुरस्कार आरी सोसायटी मार्फत 2012 मिळालेला आहे. त्यानंतर गुरुवर्य एके देसाई आदर्श शिक्षक पुरस्कार हा मराठा मंदिर फाउंडेशन मार्फत 2014 मिळालेला आहे. असे आपल्या ह्या पहिल्या सेशनचे डॉक्टर सुरेंद्र ठाकूर देसाई हे वेल नोन जॉग्राफर आहेत, रिसर्चर आहेत, त्यांनी कोस्टल जॉमॉर्फोलॉजीवर भरपूर काम केलेलं आहे. कोकण एरियामध्ये त्यांनी भरपूर अशी व्याख्यानं दिलेली आहेत. आमचे पार्वतीबाई चौगुले कॉलेज गोवा यांचं आणि आमचं भरपूर कॉलॅबोरेशन आहे. वर्षातून एकदा किंवा 2 वेळा त्यांचे आमच्याकडे लेक्चर होतात, ते आम्हाला शिक्षकांनाही गाईड करतात, विद्यार्थ्यांनाही गाईड करतात. असे हे आपल्या या सेशनचे वेल रिसर्चर आणि प्राध्यापक डॉक्टर सुरेंद्र देसाई यांनी आता या पहिल्या सेशनला आपल्या सुरुवात करावी.
थँक्यू सर. देन आय रिक्वेस्ट टू रिसोर्स पर्सन ऑफ दिस सेशन डॉक्टर सुरेंद्र ठाकूर देसाई डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ ज्योग्राफी गुडगे जोगळेकर कॉलेज रत्नागिरी.
हॅलो सर, ऐकू येत आहे?
हा येत आहे सर.
यस सर, यस सर.
थँक्यू. थँक्यू फॉर गिविंग मी दिस अपॉर्च्युनिटी टू बी पार्ट ऑफ दिस सेमिनार. I would be restricting myself to the time allotted. I'll be speaking for around 25 minutes. And I will be speaking of the experiences we had in rainwater harvesting in the Kokand region. Now, why really in Kokand region? Because we all know that Kokand is morphologically different, geologically also different, and it is one of the highest rain feed region in Maharashtra, but at the same time it feels scarcity of water during summers. So we have worked upon some rainwater harvesting structures in Kokand. A few things I would like to make it very clear in the beginning itself, that all whatever I will be speaking is something that we have done in collaboration with an NGO which is called as Jalavardhini. And this Jalavardhini is actually founded by and it is run by an expert in groundwater harvesting, rainwater harvesting, Ullas Paranjpe. He was chief engineer of the Mumbai Municipal Corporation. And technically, he is very sound because he stays in Mumbai. He has experienced the heavy rainfall as well as the drought scenario in region around Mumbai. And so he has started this rainwater harvesting as a mission after his retirement. Gopte College was fortunate to have collaboration with Dr. Paranspe, and we together have worked on establishing different rainwater harvesting structures, mechanisms in Kokand, in our college campus, as well as developing some demo setups in 2-3 places. As Dr. Sawant said, that colleges should go for these kind of structures. Now, I would like to make it a point that we have been doing rainwater harvesting to recharge our own bore wells on campus since 10-12 years. There are some good parts, there are some failures also, which I will be sharing. Additionally, we have constructed with our with the help of our students and farmers, as well as other institutes, some demonstration units, which are working units, where we can go and see how really we can construct different kind of rainwater harvesting structures. And what is typical about all these structures is that all these structures are basically made using the locally available material. So now, we all know this. We all know what exactly is rainwater harvesting. Savan sir has taken a very good recap of how really rainwater harvesting is practiced in different places. Now, actually, what is the issue? The issue is that cities have a different set of situation or condition, and they are well served. For example, the for what I have quoted in case of Mumbai, that Mumbai is well served with water. You have abundance of water in Mumbai, but that water comes from three lakes and 27 reservoirs plus five major dams, which are around 100 kilometers away. And so cities, they get water, they are well served with water from very long distances. But for a farmer, for a small town, for a small place, a village, it's very difficult to get this kind of a facility. And so what is the out, what is the way out? The way out can only be the rainwater harvesting, or what we usually call as RWC. So rainwater harvesting or rainwater conservation, basically it means storage of water in either man-made reservoir or in natural reservoir also. So rainwater conservation will not always mean that we have to construct something. We can use natural reservoir. It cannot be a reservoir even. It can be an aquifer, a cavity at subsurface. Only thing is that the water has to be available when we need it. Then only it is called as rainwater conservation. I mean, deep percolation, which happens naturally also, and we can enhance also. Now, deep percolation is not of direct use because we don't get the water when we need it. So that is the only limiting factor. Otherwise, anything that we do to store the water on the surface or below the surface in either human or man-made structures or in natural structures, cavities, everything is called as rainwater conservation. And so we have to, what do is that we have to create a way to collect the water and store it. Now, this storage is actually an issue. Now, we have seen many technical things. I mean, we have a watershed management model, which starts, which has an approach, which is called as mountain to valley approach, matha te paitha paddhati asa tala muttha. And then we have variety of structures, like we have CCT, continuous contour trench, then we have gully plugging, then we have loose boulder structures, then we have gabion structures, and n number of bunds, and then ultimately it comes into a percolation tank, and the whole watershed gets what is called as a processed or technically developed. Now, all these things are possible where you have good lithology or a lithology that supports this kind of structure. Now, it is not always that you will get a lithology which will support this kind of structure. Many a times it happens that the lithology will be very different. For example, in case of Kokand. Now, Kokand doesn't have a watershed kind of structure, especially over a larger area. Rivers have their own watersheds, but there are no clear-cut water divides for a village. A village may have very, very haphazard kind of stream network. And therefore, we have to rethink of this watershed development model. And we have, what we need is a distributed storage. Now, when we speak of any water conservation, what is exactly needed? Actually, to store water, to conserve water, we need only two things. One is that we need a structure or a support. And second is we need an impermeable membrane, a membrane that will make water to stop. It will not allow the water to pass through. That is what we need. So a structure can be a steel frame. It can be a bamboo frame. As Sahil sir told that Apatanis, I had been to Zero many times. And I have seen those Apatani rice fields because Zero is called as rice bowl of Arunachal. So Apatanis, they use bamboo structures. There are steel frame structures. Concrete walls, we all use. People who are in cities, in Chennai, every apartment in its basement has a concrete water storage tank which collects the roof water. So you can have concrete wall, we can have brick walls, even excavation, like we have a farm pond. So we don't construct a structure above the ground, but we could do excavation and create a structure. So we need a structure that will support the pressure of water. And secondly, what we need is a membrane that will not allow the water to percolate or to pass through. So a membrane can be ferrocement. Now this is very popular. This is not popular in Maharashtra, in Goa. But if you visit Telangana, especially the northern part of Telangana, you will find that ferrocement is most popular. Every house will have overhead tank made up of ferrocement. So ferrocement, that is a structure which is a mixture of iron mesh plus cement. It can be a plastic membrane. This is very popular with farm pond. What is not used is the vegetative fiber. We have developed using banana fiber traditionally, hemp fiber traditionally, even coir. In Kerala, they are using a lot of coir mats for water conservation. So any natural fiber plus cement, that is also a good impermeable membrane. Gunniting is something that I will be speaking of. If you have a vertical wall, we can go for gunniting and we can go for plastering. So these can be impermeable membranes. You do any permutation combination of a structure and membrane and you will come out with your own wall. So this is what happens. Now we'll go for an example. If you see, rainwater conservation in high rainfall region is not new. In 1973, a school or an establishment in Pajgani did rainwater harvesting. Now, Pajgani is a place which is among the highest rainfall receiving place in Western Ghats. It's one among the highest, not highest, but it receives a lot of rainfall. And still in 1973, an educational complex went for rainwater harvesting. And they have been harvesting at least 10 lakh liters of water every year since 1970. This is the success story. So it is not that we are doing something new. Only thing is that we have to do it. That is what is boring. Now we'll go for what kind of structures we have. Now this is a very common structure. We can use the roof water for a direct recharge of the underground storage. Now, in this case, the storage is artificial or storage is constructed by people. So you may have underground tank, you may have underground cavity, a basement, anything, and that can be converted into a storage. And only roof water, you will just put the roof water. Only care has to be taken is that either you have to put filter at the front end, that is the filter water will go inside, or you will have to treat the water before using it. Both of the things are in practice, but this is what we have, and this has been in practice in few places in Mumbai, Pune, large cities, but we have farmers or even resorts which are having these structures. Now these structures can be very well integrated in the home itself. If you don't have good space, people have water tank in basement. And they have the They can collect the water or they can monitor the system inside their home. So their home is, they are sitting on water. They are sitting on water storage, and this plinth-based water structure are very cost effective because they don't need any additional source or they don't need any additional construction. Already excavation is there, plinth, concrete structures are there. Only thing is that you have to do the waterproofing, and this can be very useful structures. This is another good example. A village farmer has constructed his own water tank. Now this village is not receiving, I mean, it receives good rainfall, but it is at the top, on the top of a hill. And so there is no other way of conserving water. You cannot construct a bund, you cannot construct a diversion, you can't do anything. Only thing you can do is that you have your own tank. And so what he has done is that his front yard itself is a water tank. And whatever water is collected on the tiled roof, that goes into this tank. And his front yard is a water tank. He collects around 90,000 liters of water in his front yard. And he can very well enjoy this water for 5.5 months, which are scarcity of water. So he has to, unfortunately, ladies have to bear this burden. So they used to take water uphill for about 2 kilometers before in the old days, but now they are having water in their front yard. And this is a fantastic example of how really we can go for water conservation. Now this is another example. Laterite brick is very commonly available material. And this laterite brick material is available in Kokan because we have laterite plateaus. It's quite sturdy, it's lightweight. And you can have these kind of structures at the top. Now what are the limitations to these structures also, ideally speaking? So we will find that these structures are available and we can go up to 2 meters for these kind of structures, definitely not beyond that. And you don't need any pumping in of water. So laterite structures are also available. So this can be one option. This man is actually having 3 such structures in his own farm, and he is an engineer by profession, but he came back to his village and he is storing around 3 lakh liters of water. He is supplying water in summer to needy people also. So this is one way out. Farm pond with silpolin is very popular structure. Now farm ponds are popular, as Sawant sir mentioned, in Pani Foundation model, in Marathwada also, in Kokand, everywhere. Only issue with farm pond is the rate of evaporation. Usually farm ponds are not used for percolation. They are used for drying the water directly. And the rate of evaporation is the main issue in case of farm pond, because the surface is extensive. Now there are some oil additives available. So you can just spray that oil on water. So that oil is not harmful, but that creates a layer on the surface of water, and it actually protects the water from evaporation. So that can be one way out. But farm ponds are very popular. They are easily constructed. Only issue with farm ponds in Kokan is about the animals which are in the soil. They are called as boring animals, especially the crabs. All farmers will complain that crabs are the enemy for farm ponds. And the crabs, they collect. So silpolin is a material that is now available. It's a kind of plastic. And this material, you cannot puncture this material. It can be extended. It gets elongated, but it's very difficult to puncture. And so this silpolin has been the solution to the problem of the crab and cracking of material. But this is one way. A coir tank, as I said, these tanks are smaller in size because you need a distributed network. Ultimately, you may have water, but the cost of drawing the water and carrying the water has to be minimized. Then only these models will be successful and they will be adapted. They have to be economically viable. So this is a coir tank. This we have constructed. Our students have constructed. It's a simple structure with no machinery. We can do it. this is coir plus cement layer on it, and lime is used usually because to keep the pests away, and you don't also get algal growth if you put lime. So this white color is the lime that is pested, and this lime helps in keeping water clean. So this is very popular structure, and you will find that this structure has got no limitation of size. You can construct it for 1 feet by 1 feet, 10 feet by 10 feet, or 10 feet by 30 feet, anything possible. And coir is quite abundantly available. Now we have coir max also. So that helps in these structures. What we have been thinking, or we have practiced, but this requires huge amount of funds, is that why can't we convert the unused or the left out lateritic mines into the water storage structures. Now, lateritic mining is done on the top of the plateau. So, the advantage is that the water is collected at the top, and the settlements in Konkan are usually on slopes or at the valley bottom. So, naturally, you can fetch the water using gravity. And no additional pumping will be required if we use. But the only issue in this case is that the cost involved. So you have lateritic quarries which are abandoned, and no one goes for filling of these quarries, though there are rules. Actually, in monsoon, these quarries are full of water. One suggestion is that these quarries actually help in groundwater recharge. But the problem is that in case of laterite, the porosity is very high, and the porous structure is not regular as in case of basalt. So why watershed management was very successful in basalt was that the structure of basalt is very regular. So you can predict that if you conserve water at the top, at the valley bottom, you will get a spring. But this you cannot predict in case of laterite. So if you store water here naturally, we cannot predict that where the water will go, whether it will move in all directions or one direction. It's very unpredictable, and therefore, but somewhere it will be. So quarries developed into water tanks, that is one. But can be better option is that we will do now guniting to the quarries. Guniting is just making the walls of the quarries waterproof. If we make the walls of the quarries waterproof, then the quarries will be overhead tanks, and we can draw water from quarries, and you will not have to spend a single pay to pump it. I mean, using gravity, you can draw the water. So this is what we have experimented. Only thing is that the gunniting costs. Now, different models we are trying. A paddy straw, silpaulin model of gunniting seems to be the answer. Hope that the things will be useful in future. Now, what we have tried on our campus is direct recharge of borehole. Usually, for recharge of groundwater recharge, people go for soakage pits. Now, there are recharge wells also. In very dry regions like Daivadi, you will have recharge wells. A borewell not to draw water, but to put water inside. So why don't we use our own borewell as a channel to recharge the aquifer? Because borewells, they use raw water from some aquifer. Can we use the same borewell to put back the water into the aquifer? That was the idea. And so we selected two rooftops. One was ladies hostel of our college, has got a rooftop of around 9,000 square feet. And we have a gymkhana building, which has a rooftop of around 2,000. So 11,000 square feet area was available. And we collected all the water from that 11,000 square feet through pipe system. And then we put a sand filter. And then we just poured this water from coming out from sand filter into our borewell. Now the experience was very nice. I mean, we are in high rainfall region, but we are in water scarcity part of Ratnagiri city, our college campus. And so we used to purchase water, especially for ladies hostel. And we used to purchase around 50 to 55 tankers of water per year. Now the amount, now the number of tankers has gone down to 10 to 15. So we could save 40 tankers. That is, we could recharge 40 into 10,000 liters of water. Now, this is the volume that we could recharge. Only problem we started feeling was that if the borewell is not having the complete casing, usually to save money, what people do is that they do partial casing. So they don't put casing pipe till the bottom. If it is partially casing is done, then it may happen that the lower strata may go for seepage or may sink in if the water flow is very high. That is the only thing we have to take care of. If you have a hard rock strata, then your borewell can be recharged directly. No need of any additional thing. But if you have a soft rock strata at the bottom, you will have to think about the casing there. So while constructing or while digging a borewell, if you want to recharge it, this is the lesson that we learned. It was a failure in 5 years. And then we learned that while we are going for borewell, we will have put casing pipe for a complete length. And that then again, we can go for borewell recharge. So this is what we have. Now about rainwater, everything depends on what is the availability. So what is more important is that how to calculate the volume of water we can store. It's very simple. Actually, the amount of rainfall that we get in centimeters, if we say, that is the water column that we can generate over the ground. So Ratnagiri receives around 3000 millimeters of water, that is 3 meters. So we can have a water column of 3 meters on ground. If we store all the water, we will have a water column of 3 meters. 3 meters is 10 feet of water column. So whatever area, that is the water column. Now in the case of Dahivadi, it can be half a meter. If it's 500 millimeters, it will be half meter. So that is the water column. Actually, that is the limiting factor. Okay, so you cannot construct a tank beyond this height because it will be never filled. If you want to fill it with rain, the height of your storage structure has to be less than the water column. That makes it cost effective. And you multiply this by the area available, that will give you the total volume. So if you have 100 centimeters of rainfall, and if you construct a tank of 1 square meter, you will save 1000 liter without any pumping or putting in. Only you put it open and rain will fill it. So you can conserve 1000 liter of water using 1 square meter tank with a height of 100 centimeters. This is very simple calculation. And you can estimate the total capacity of your campus to collect the water. You will find that in very scanty rainfall region of Maharashtra, you can collect at least 3 lakh liters of water over the area. And so this is very high volume of water. So if you calculate the water, rainwater potential, rainwater conservation potential, you can actually think of how really or how possible it is. Now, another problem is that why we go for rainwater conservation, because the most important part of any conservation measure is the cost effectiveness. Because anything can be done in the world, provided you have money. And money is the major issue. A college educational institute or a small farmer, if he is going for rainwater conservation, how much he can spend? Now, it's very simple. You compare it with the commercially available products. For example, we call it as a syntex tank or a plastic tank. Now you go to market and see, you will get that all the plastic tanks, it will be single layer, double layer, and now we have triple layer plastic plants. They cost around 5.5 rupees to 7 rupees per liter. This was last year's rate. I don't know what it is this year, but the costing is around 6 to 8, 7, 8 rupees per meter. So if you want to purchase 100 liters tank, it comes out to be 700 rupees. If you want to go for 1000, it goes to 7000 rupees. So this is very simple calculation. If you go for construction of a concrete tank, what we do in our homes, an underground tank, the costing goes up to 8.5 to 10 rupees minimum. So this is the cost that you have to spend. Now, what is important about this rainwater harvesting or rainwater conservation structures that we are speaking about is there that we can construct these structures at a cost of 2 to 3.5 rupees per liter. So they are very cost effective, half the cost. You want to store 1000 liter of water in a plastic tank, you have to spend 7000 rupees, but you can construct a ferrocement tank within 3500 rupees. You can construct banana fiber tank within 2000 rupees, or you can construct a coco peat fiber tank within 2500 rupees. So it's very cost effective, and that is the key, that is the crux of it. Secondly, it can be constructed with locally available skill and manpower. Our students have constructed the tanks. They have done it. No great skill, no great technology, no great machine needed. Everything locally available skills can be done, and much of the material is locally available. What you need is a mesh. So wire mesh and chicken mesh are available in any hardware shop. And you get some plinth material locally, and cement is available, sand is available. So only these things, and a layman can construct. So rainwater conservation structures are actually beneficial because they are very low cost structures. Anywhere you go in India, the costs will be such. So this has been very successful. Now this photograph I am showing, because the detail can be as simple as rudimentary, a small ditch with a simple in sheet and a straw lid. That's all. A farmer has gone for plantation of mango trees, and he planted 1000 mango trees, and he had 250 such small ponds. In between four mango trees, there is one pond, and he waters all those mango trees using this pond. He has done everything by his own, no labor needed. No construction, no machine, only silpaulin he has to purchase. Otherwise, everything he has done. So rainwater conservation, especially in India, where you have assured rainfall by monsoon, it can be less, but it is assured. Everybody will receive less rainfall, no issue. But if you are receiving 500 millimeters, you are assured that you will get 500 millimeters. So in such rainfall assured region like India, we can go for rainwater conservation structures. And I think that these structures, though they look very small, they look very shabby. Actually, these are the small steps that will take you to the long distances. So the self-sufficiency of water, for that, one path can be such rainwater harvesting structures. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Dr. Diute, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Yanantar mi ya session cha chairperson ani resource person cha avar manyasathi nimantrit karto. Dr. P. V. Patil, sir. Sambhajirao Kadam Mahavidyalaya Deur. Patil, sir.
Okay, sir. I can let it?
Yatay, sir. Yatay, bol.
Okay. I am thankful to Thakur Desai sir for giving his nice presentation and sharing his experiences in rainwater harvesting in Konkan region. He also gave some example that is Jalvardhani NGO like rainwater harvesting in Pasgani, and also giving some types of rainwater harvesting, that is core tank, farmyard tank, and also laterite mine. How it is useful laterite mines for rainwater harvesting. He has also a very interesting lecture for us, and I think that this lecture is very quite useful for listeners. So thank you very much, Dr. Desai, Thakur Desai sir. And also I am thank you, Dr. Edge sir, for his introducing the Thakur Desai sir. Now over to the Devadi College, please. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Then let us start to second session of this webinar. I request to Dr. Sanjay Gaikwad to introduce the resource person of this seminar. Dr. Gaikwad.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Hello.
Hi, sir. Bola.
So.
Video chalu kara.
Yes, yes, yes. Yes, karta kar. Hello.
Hi, sir. ये तो आवाज येतोय तो व्हिडिओ चालू करा.
ओके
ओके
गुड आफ्टरनून. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई कॉन्ग्रेचुलेट द पार्टनर्स इन ऑर्गनाइजिंग दिस वन डे वेबिनार दैवड कॉलेज और पार्वतीबाई चौगले कॉलेज. आई टेक अपॉर्चुनिटी टू बी अ चेयरपर्सन फॉर दिस सेशन. And I have given responsibility to introduce Dr. Sachin Tendulkar. He is a chief executive officer of Mineral Foundation of Goa. I have been in contact with him from last 16 years. He has completed his PhD in horticulture from Indian Agricultural Research Institute, New Delhi. He is also a very active researcher. After that, he has got a Fulbright Fellowship in 2007. And Endeavor Executive Award in 2011. He is a chief executive officer at Mineral Foundation, as I said in the beginning. So he has also executed several research activities that are benefiting the society, as well as initiating the various programs of Mineral Foundations for the well-being of the peoples in the mining areas. And I have personally worked on several topics with him that were given us for the as a part of research as well as consultancy projects from Mineral Foundation. So personally, from my side as well as from the organizer side, I welcome Dr. Sachin Tendulkar to give a special address to the gathering. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Then I request to Dr. Tendulkar, Chief Executive Officer, Mineral Foundation of Goa.
नमस्कार सर.
नमस्कार सर. अगोदर व्हिडिओ चालू करा.
जस्ट अ मिनिट. गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन.
आवाज कमी येतोय.
हां, एम आय ऑडिबल नाउ?
हां यस सर.
हां, गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन. थैंक्स फॉर दिस अपॉर्च्युनिटी टू चौगले कॉलेज एंड दैवड़ी कॉलेज. I'll be speaking more from my experiences of last 10-15 years, which are associated with watershed management in Goa, with specific reference to Goa. So without spending much time, I'll directly move to my presentation and we can look at the details. Is my screen visible to everyone?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Awaaz fakta, sir, kami yetoy thoda. Awaaz zara vadva.
Okay. Aata yetoy ka, barobar?
Yetoy.
Okay. Yeah. So, Goa is always perceived to be a very water abundant state because we are in a zone where we receive around 3.5 350 centimeter to 400 centimeter of rainfall. But as Dr. Sawan mentioned earlier, we always have shortage in some or the other pockets of Goa, even during the rainy season. Partly they are man-made because we have a probably poor management of that resource, and partly because of technical problem, because during June, July, we have a lot of turbid water and all the filtration plant which are working, they get their screens get jammed because of the all the suspended particulate matter and the clay matter, and as a result usually June months are very stressful as far as water supply through pipe water is concerned. Now, Goa, as we can see here, it's made up of 12 taluka with an area of 3,702 square kilometer. If you see, this area, which are the foothills of Western Ghat, are more of a recharge zone, whereas the coastal part of all must be very familiar with Kalangut Beach or Miramar Beach or Vasco or in south Agonda Beach and all. Now these are the area where there is a very high population density. You can say up to 700 person per square kilometer. Whereas as you move towards the interior part of Goa, the population density goes on decreasing. If you see the drainage pattern of Goa, it is more of a dendritic pattern with this is very high sloping area, all these interior talukas. And as you move towards Arabian Sea, the slope lessens and it is more of a flat area, but these are all again sandy areas. Here you can see that all this dark blue are very highly sloping, and then as you move towards coast, it is less sloping. Now we have major 9 rivers. Out of that, Mandavi and Zuari are the major rivers. So if you can see here, they sort of drain the major part of Goa. Sattari and Darbandoda, Ticholi, Tiswadi and part of Bardes is drained by Mandavi river, whereas Ponda and Sange and part of Kepe is drained by Zuari river. And these are more of an interstate river. We have now have some sort of a dispute with Karnataka, and here this area we get it from again Karnataka area, famous Dudhsagar or Kandepar river. Now why watershed? Everyone, when we started work, I started working with the community in year 1998 on watershed development, and that time we visited Ahmednagar for water and Raligan city, and some of were of the opinion that Goa being a lateritic having lateritic plateau and lateritic soil will not fetch that those kind of dividends which has been fetched by the Maharashtra. But nevertheless, since there were a lot of problem of water shortage in many of those interior areas. And let me make a statement here that many of these interior areas over the period of time have changed in land use. Though you might see the greenery there, the native forests have been removed and they have been substituted by exotic crop, that is cashew. Now, cashew is not a Goa-based crop. It was brought in by Portuguese to be grown on a very poor soil. But over a period of time, since it is a cash crop, most of our interior areas have been occupied by this cashew crop. And as a result, there is a competition between the native vegetation and this cashew crop. So watershed program basically tries to restore this surface to subsurface approach. In the sense, in a cashew grow, you usually have clean cultivation, and when the rain comes in, we have problem of sheet erosion or drop erosion or gully erosion, and over a period of time all these land become less responsive to water recharge. Again, there is a lot of public movement and there is compaction of the soil, and then the water percolation gets reduced. This cashew crop, if you see during the summer season when all other crops are stressed, this produces beautiful apples which have a lot of water or juice in it. So basically it is contesting with all the native vegetation which otherwise saves on water. Now another challenge, even during this COVID time and even earlier, though the Goa is having very good social and economic indicator, as you move inwards, there are a lot of community in the villages which are still working towards meeting their basic needs. So providing them employment and ensuring that we have more and more recharge in these areas, because the demand of water is more in coastal areas and recharge can happen only in the interior areas, because recharge cannot happen more in coastal areas. Someone is playing. Okay, recharge.
cannot happen in coastal area. So we have a problem with sandy soil or a problem with plain the surroundings. So as we need to have a distinction between two of these places, recharge zones and then usage zones. So why watershed is very essential? Because one is it gives us bottom up planning. Now these all these experiments have been done in Maharashtra on a big scale, but Goa we have a very specific problem because the community here is involved in some or the other kind of works, and there are very little number of person or less number of people available for manual work. So it was a challenge when we took up this watershed activity, but over a period of time we were able to get the confidence of people into this watershed activity, and that was basically because we engaged the community for a long time before we actually implemented the project. So first thing was bottom up planning. So we involved local community and took their the native or the indigenous knowledge into account, and also worked with certain technical aspect of watershed, and it was a good understanding between people what they had and then the knowledge of their surrounding. And not that our people were not water literate, I think in between somewhere we have forgotten it, because earlier if you look at these forts, especially Raigad or Murud Janjira or Sindhudurg, you will have water security already ensured in these forts. And the same way Goa also during this Gaonkari system also had lot of areas which were used for storing and conservation of water resources. So first thing what we indulged in was bottom up planning. Second was need based planning, because we found out what kind of crop is there. Goa fortunately has very less of sugarcane area, which I would personally consider as a water guzzling crop, but more of a plantation crop. And thirdly, we looked at those local resources. We knew that we have certain limitation, as Professor Thakur Desai has said, that we have limitation of this lateritic plateau, and then same amount of water which probably could be stored in Deccan plateau may not be available in our area. So we also, but when we looked in our surrounding, we found this lateritic plateau also acted as soil water recharge zone. Because all this lateritic plateau on their slope or either at base had springs which were fed by this lateritic plateau and which were yielding water for year round. So we had this famous Kesarwal spring or local spring near Pardes or down south in Rivona. So there were plenty number of springs which were fed by this lateritic plateau. But over a period of time, because of urbanization and because of pressure on land, these lateritic plateaus have been built upon, and the recharge capacity of this lateritic plateau has been totally destroyed. Secondly, same time there have been industrial estate which have come all across this lateritic plateau, and there is a lot of water draw, and there is no adequate water recharge. Fourth thing was participation and ownership. I think when we talk about Jal Shakti Mission, and as Dr. Sawant has mentioned earlier, that watershed approach is one of the subcomponent of Jal Shakti Mission. We need to make it a people's mission. Jal Shakti and Jan Shakti should go together, because otherwise, in between, when we have forgotten this water literacy, we need to ensure that every individual in our village and in our urban area need to know from where their water comes and for what it should be used and how it should be used responsibly. Another component in watershed was voluntary labor. In order to make the community more responsive, we wanted to take Shramadan from them. That means they have to give voluntary labor and a good leadership. So what are the mantras of watershed? One was catch rain where it falls. That means each and every drop, even before it starts traveling on surface, it should be, we should ensure that this water gets into the soil. Secondly, surface runoff to subsurface movement. So any amount of water which falls on surface should immediately be converted into subsurface recharge, so that the minimal damage to surface environment is there. Otherwise, there are chances of a lot of erosion. So second mantra is about from surface runoff to subsurface movement. Third is from running water to walk. In the sense, you have to reduce the speed of the water. So if we have more and more water moving on the surface, it, over a period of time, it gains speed and then it can gain erosive velocity. So third thing was for making running water to walk and walking water to crawl. Fourthly, provide more time for water in higher areas. As we are all aware that higher areas, when they are recharged, they will ensure that the lower springs, lower wells or lower spouts in either river or rivulets will be remain always recharged. Fifth thing was vegetation cover. So beside ensuring that we provide employment to the local area, another focus was to increase the biomass, because with increased biomass you have less of evaporation losses. Probably it may be converted into other kind of losses, but not to the extent when the soil is open. Sixth is increase in time of concentration. That means when the water moves from higher areas to lower areas, if you have a lot of biomass, if you have a lot of hurdle, the time taken by water to travel from ridge to valley will be increased. And by the time the water from lower areas moves out of watershed, the water from upper areas will slowly move to lower areas. So we don't have that kind of flood situation which usually arises in a watershed which are more concretized, which are more built up, which are more asphalted. Sixth was ridge to valley approach, because this has to be done in a particular fashion. And all these things were made known to community. And while we plan for the watershed development, we took into account the natural, social and physical resources of the area, including people who have land, people who did not have land, and other people who do not have stake, because they also play a very important part in watershed development. And lastly, it has to be done in a phased manner. That means we start on mountain top in first year, then move downwards, and then ultimately we reach to the valley. Now this is a typical picture of a watershed. The white line indicates the ridge line. That means it's an imaginary line which joins all the points of very high elevation. And when the rainfall comes or when there is a precipitation, all this water will move through these different drainages and move out of this watershed. So this is an outlet of watershed. So it's a hydrogeological unit which will encompass area of maybe 800, 900 to 1000 hectares, and which will include different kind of resources like agriculture land, fruit crops, your human component, animal component, and all other kind of usages. Now let me get to the kind of intervention which we did in this watershed. First thing what we adopted was trenching, and this was done on a massive scale. These trenches were staggered trenches. If you move to Deccan areas, those are CCTV or continuous contour trenches. But in high rainfall area like Goa, we adopted small or staggered trenches, and more so arranged in a fashion of a triangle. In the sense, two, three points of the triangle we ensured. So the water which is moving down in between two trenches will be intercepted by the third trench. So these kind of trenches were made, and we had a challenge especially with cashew crop, because we cannot dig trenches near the cashew. They had to be dug either upward or downward of the cashew crop, because if you damage the roots, then they are again infestation of borer and all. So these were the practical aspect which were made known to the local community. So what we did was we moved, we sort of organized the local community in self-help groups and user groups. We formed a watershed association and we bound them together into a cohesive group which was restricted to that particular watershed area. And then we got in funding from the government under NAWDAPRA or NWDPRA, that is National Watershed Development Program. Or another program was Integrated Development Program, Haryali Guideline, Common Guideline. So under that, Goa government gave in funds and we were sort of a project implementing agency and got people together. So a myth that that is there amongst people outside Goa, that Goa is all about fun and frolic and not much of activity happens. Let me say that till date, around 51 to 52 micro watershed have been treated in Goa in different parts. I'll come to that map later on. So this is how it appears once the rain sets in and water which is harvested. Now this trench, which is of 1.5 meter length by 0.5 meter width by 0.5 meter depth dimension, harvest near about 33 cubic meter of water over a period of entire rain. So typically the CCTV will appear like this, whereas the staggered trenches are more so arranged in this fashion. This is another measure which we adopted. Now once the trenches get filled as the rain moves from June to July and the soil become more and more sort of saturated, the trenches get filled very immediately and then the water starts moving down. And so we adopted something called a sunken pond. Now this sunken pond, which was done entirely by village ladies in Rivona, and that costed during those time only around 14,000, can harvest nearly 10 to 15,000 liters of water with one flush of rain. And the beauty of this kind of structure is they don't take much of area. The dia is hardly 10 meter and the depth will be around 1.5 to 2 meter. Over a period of time, we changed the design of the sunken pond. This is more deeper and slope, the sides are more slopy. Whereas later on, we made them into a saucer shape so that we have more surface area increased and more water percolation is there or water recharge is there. So this was a design which was adopted later on and we went on modifying this design as per the local condition. Once the water moves from our trenches to sunken pond and sunken pond gets filled, water starts moving into drainage line. That means small gullies which move from your mountain top to downward. And the first line of defense in this kind of gullies is the live check dam or check dam which are made using poles and twigs and twines, and ensure that all the movement of the surface soil particle which otherwise would move down is arrested here, and then only the clean water will move down. Now second line of defense in this drain line was gully plugs, small kind of boulder plugs which will ensure that all the catchment area, if you can see, you can see here another gully plug and then there are more on top. So as the water moves from side into this drain line, all this vegetable or vegetative decaying matter is arrested by this gully plug and only clean water will move downwards. Again, all this kind of intervention, including the trenches, the sunken ponds, the gully plugs, will increase the time of concentration. That means for a liter of water to move from this portion of surface to downward will instead take a lot of time. In normal circumstances, if it had to move within an hour, this will take around 2 hours or 3 hours by the time it arrives here. So these are closed view of a gully plug, and all these were made by local people. So there was no contract involved and this has generated a lot of employment. So when we think of a post-COVID situation wherein people do not have employment or there are restrictions on migration into other areas, I think watershed approach can beautifully fit into creating opportunities for people. So these are kind of small structures which were adopted and which were taken up. And once you make this kind of structure, the local community had that sense of achievement. And I would say they celebrated each and every aspect of that watershed, that number of check dams they made, the number of gully plugs they made, the number of trenches they dug. So all this was very well celebrated by local community, and they got a renewed confidence that they can contribute. And every time when we say watershed, we say time of concentration, all these technical jargons, when if we have to explain to local people, I think we need to get down to their level and make them understand that it's not only watershed or water harvesting is not about more about technical jargons, but about simple science and how to implement it on ground. So I can say with confidence that today 3-4 of our village key person are also trainers in as far as watershed structures are concerned. So what we did was, first we got the first batch of people trained as training of trainers, and later on this trained people imparted training to other villages. So that sort of a gap that only technical people can pick up these skills was slowly busted. So this is a view of a loose boulder check dam, which is usually on top very narrow, and as you move downwards, it is more broader. So this is upstream area and this is downstream. You can see that all this vegetative matter, which otherwise would have drained into a nearby stream and filled up that space which usually holds water, is arrested here. This will convert into a beautiful manure, and the same can be used by people on the site. At the same time, it also filters the water and ensures that only clean water moves downward, and again it increases the time of water retention here. So the water gets into the soil and slowly recharges the aquifer. Now, as we move downward, there is a series of structures. So first we will have brushwood check dam, then we will have gully plugs, then check loose boulder check dam, and then we come to gabion. Now, this gabion was constructed by local people. So people were trained to twine this specific kind of wire, which is GI wire, into this kind of a boxes, and then the boxes were filled by using the stones which are available into the rivulet, and they were keystones were put on either side so that the more amount of force of water do not wash the sides, and the water moves into the center, and then it moves into a cascading effect downward. So this is a view of a gabion, wherein you can see on either side the sides have been secured, and a good amount of water only moves downward. So, and these are at the lower end of a watershed, so that as water moves down, it gets filtered, the soil component gets settled upstream, and only clean water moves down. So as we move down, we go and construct open type bandaras. So these open type bandaras are on the small rivulet or on big rivers. So Goa have now near about 200 of open type big bandaras. So that has ensured security of water in urban areas. So our water treatment plants are fed by this open type bandara. So every time there is a shortage, one open type bandara will be opened and water will move downwards toward the barrage, and from there it is lifted and filtered and supplied. So our previous late chief minister, he had that kind of vision wherein he implemented lot of open type bandaras, and the fruits are reaped by all of us now. This is another structure which Professor Thakur Desai also spoke about, the Jalkund. And this is slightly bigger in size. This is about 2.5 to 3 meter in length, 1.5 to 2 meter in width, and around 1.5 meter in depth. So this stores huge amount of water, and this water is used as a critical irrigation input, especially on the mountain tops. So idea is to ensure that every drop of water is either forced into soil or it is temporarily stored and used after the rains. So the dependence more on groundwater or dependence more on borewell water is reduced. This is a view of Jalkund again. Farm ponds also, Dr. Sawant has spoken, Dr. Thakur Desai has spoken. And these are basically now challenge in Goa is we have very little of less of land surface, which is available for agriculture and for other activity, because a lot of land surface is occupied by building. So it's always a challenge even to ensure that big area is made available for conservation or storage of water. Because if you handle average land holding is less than 0.2 hectare. So 80% of Goan farmers own less than 2 hectares of land. So even sparing a few square meter of land is always a challenge. So the focus of this watershed approach is more on a decentralized thing. So whether when you dig trenches, when you put gully plugs, when you construct check dams, not much of area is disturbed. But the benefits are reaped by the local community, and also it creates employment opportunities for local community and keep them glued into the village system. So this is a small slide which shows you how many people were involved. So these are around 13 self-help group, and each consisting of near about 10 to 12 people. So around 150 to 200 people were involved in all this work. And this is from 2012 to 2017, we implemented one micro watershed, which was the latest. And as you can see, they dug near about 79,830 trenches, 299 gully plug they installed. They constructed 151 loose boulder check dam, sunken pond around 43, gabion 34, and live fencing more than 10 kilometers. The amount of money which was totally spent on all these activities was hardly 49 lakhs. So,
hello?
Hello? This was 49 lakhs. And as is evident that instead of end of pipe solution, if we ensure that we look at a catchment management or watershed management in its totality, which involves very less of expenditure, but creating more opportunities and without destroying nature or more into sustainable way, then I think the way forward to go is through catchment management on resilience based approach. This is a map of watershed which have been taken over the years by different project implementing agencies in Goa, and some are proposed for next plan period. That means when you see this green or 13 or 14 5-year plan, they are yet to be implemented, but there is a sizable number of watershed which have been already implemented in different parts of Goa. This is a table which depicts water level in one particular well of Mr. Raghu Dekar. His total depth of well is 4.56 meter. And when we took up watershed work in 2012-13, his well used to hit bottom during April or May month. And as we move forward, after we implemented watershed measures, as is evident, the water level was only up to 3.93. And next year it was up to 3.1 in the same period. Only again there was severe heat during this year, and again it went down to 4.15. We couldn't take the further. Again, let me mention here, we have not taken the pump out test here. So what I would seek in intervention of students and for educational institute, especially under Unnat Bharat, is to work with this NGO community and work with government and ensure that they handle more of this technical aspect, because probably the colleges have this kind of expertise and they can make good of this expertise, even geotagging of this different structure using GIS facility and all. So I end my presentation here. Let me say that if we have good connect between educational institute, the non-profit organization and the government, then this water security for future generation will not be much of a problem. Secondly, the end of pipe solution, rather than looking at interlinking of rivers or pumping from one river basin to another river basin, may not be really sustainable solutions. And through our watershed over last 10 years, we have found that the local water table can increase from 15 centimeter to 40 centimeter on an average, and that too in a lateritic system like Goa. So I feel there are good scope for rainwater harvesting and watershed through public participation, even in more developed state like Goa. And also that would same apply to Konkan Belt and down south in Uttar Kannada district also. So thank you very much for giving me this opportunity, and I stop here.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. In fact, you know, sir has many live cases because he has been working in this field for several months, at least 2 decades, we can say. And that's why I know there were many insights of the local case studies and many photographs and all these things. And he has a very close contact with the, all the members, all self-help groups, and every beneficiaries that have been depending on the watershed management and development related works. Okay, and he is also very having a very active and key role in the execution of the projects from the Goa Middle Foundations. So I'm thankful to sir, and I extend this session to the organizers. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Then I request to Mr. S.R. Soban for propose the vote of thanks. Soban, sir.
Oh.
Video chalu kara.
Hello.
Haan, bola. Yeto awaz. Video chalu kara.
एक दिवसीय नॅशनल वेबिनारसाठी उपस्थित असलेले सर्व शिक्षक वृंद व विद्यार्थी या सर्वांचे मी भूगोल विभागातर्फे मनपूर्वक आभार मानतो. धन्यवाद.
थँक्यू सर. देन इट इज टाइम टू सॅल्युटरी फंक्शन. आय heartily welcome to all delegates in the webinar, and I request to introduce the all delegates to Dr. VP Gaikwad sir, HOD and convener of the this webinar. Gaikwad sir.
Thank you, sir. I would like to thank principal Dr. Shaila Ghanti Madam, who is the chief guest of this valedictory function. I am very much thanked to permission for organize this webinar. Dr. Shaila Ghanti Madam is the Department of Computer Science and very much experience in research and also administrative. So I welcome from my college to Shaila Ghanti Madam. Then I request to give his guidance. Thank you, sir. Madam, please.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
Hi, Toya Vaj.
Good evening to one and all. I, Dr. Shaila Ghanti, officiating principal of Parvati Bhai Chogle College, extremely happy to be part of this valedictory function of national webinars sponsored by ICSSR IMPRIS research project on sustainable development of rainwater harvesting and artificial groundwater recharge in India, organized by Department of Geography of Parvati Bhai Chogle College, Margao, Goa, and Daivadi College of Daivadi District, Satara, Maharashtra. I congratulate Professor N.N. Sawant and the team for taking this initiative and organizing this event. This topic is highly relevant because water is precious and the need to conserve water and develop sustainable model is very important. I'm sure that this webinar was very helpful to all the participants and also must have given many new innovative ideas and thoughts in this regard, okay, which might further lead to maybe new startups or new research or community level work, and I feel there will be a lot of scope to work in this area. With this, my special appreciation to Dr. Vijay Gaikwad, convener, and Professor Nandakumar Sawant, coordinator of the conference, and thank you all.
Thank you, ma'am. Then I request to in charge principal, Dr. B.S. Balwant, sir, Dehwadi College, Dehwadi, to give his presidential speech.
Dehwadi College, Dehwadi, आणि पार्वतीबाई चौगुले कॉलेज गोवा या दोन महाविद्यालयाच्या भूगोल विभागाच्या वतीनं आयोजित केलेला या ऑनलाईन राष्ट्रीय वेबिनारच्या समारोप समारंभाच्या प्रमुख पाहुण्या माननीय डॉक्टर शैला घंटी मॅडम या वेबिनारला जॉईन झालेले शिवाजी विद्यापीठ, गोवा विद्यापीठ, मुंबई विद्यापीठातील, सोलापूर विद्यापीठातील प्राध्यापक बंधू आणि भगिनींनो, आमच्या या भूगोल विभागाच्या वतीनं हे जे राष्ट्रीय वेबिनार आयोजित केलेलं आहे, या वेबिनारचा निश्चितपणे आपणा सर्वांना फायदा होईल, आपल्या विद्यार्थ्यांना याचा फायदा होईल. एकूणच या वेबिनारच्या उद्घाटन समारंभापासून अगदी आतापर्यंतच्या या समारोप समारंभाच्या कार्यक्रमापर्यंत सर्व मान्यवरांनी अतिशय चांगल्या पद्धतीनं आमच्या पार्टिसिपंटना मार्गदर्शन केलेलं आहे आणि सकाळी 10:30 अगदी आता 1 ऑनलाईन जॉईन झालेले जे पार्टिसिपंट्स आहेत त्यांची संख्या पाहता निश्चितपणे या विषयाला या विभागाने न्याय देण्याचा प्रयत्न केलेला आहे असं मला वाटतं. आज या समारोप समारंभाप्रसंगी माननीय डॉक्टर शैला घंटी मॅडम यांनी कमी शब्दामध्ये आपले चांगले विचार व्यक्त केले, त्याचबरोबर सचिन तेंडुलकर, के सी मल्होत्रा, आमचे मित्र संभाजी शिंदे या सर्वांनी फोटोग्राफी असेल, वेगवेगळ्या प्रकारचे मॅप्स असतील या माध्यमामधून अतिशय प्रमाणभूत अशी माहिती या विद्यार्थी मित्रांना, प्राध्यापक मित्रांना दिलेली आहे. पुन्हा एकदा खूप वेळ चाललेला या कार्यक्रमाच्या समारोप समारंभाच्या निमित्तानं आपल्या सर्वांना याचा फायदा होईल अशा प्रकारचा एक आशावाद माझ्या मनामध्ये आहे आणि आपण सर्वजण सकाळपासून या वेबिनारला जॉईन झाला त्याबद्दल महाविद्यालयाच्या वतीनं आपल्या सर्वांना मनपूर्वक धन्यवाद. आणि ज्या मार्गदर्शक आमच्या सहकारी पाहुण्यांनी आम्हाला या प्रसंगी अतिशय आपला मौलिक वेळ देऊन जे ऑनलाईन मार्गदर्शन केलेलं आहे त्याबद्दल त्यांना धन्यवाद देतो आणि मी या ठिकाणी थांबतो. धन्यवाद सर.
धन्यवाद सर. दहिवडी कॉलेज दहिवडी रे शिक्षण संस्थेच्या दहिवडी कॉलेज दहिवडीच्या माध्यमातून आणि पार्वतीबाई चौगुले कॉलेजच्या माध्यमातून या ठिकाणी आयोजित केलेल्या एक दिवसीय राष्ट्रीय ऑनलाईन चर्चा सत्रामध्ये सकाळी 10:00 आता जवळजवळ 1 म्हणजे गेले 2.5 आपण सर्वजण या ठिकाणी ऑनलाईन या वेबिनारमध्ये सहभागी झालेलो आहोत. सकाळच्या सुरुवातीच्या सत्रामध्ये इनॉग्रल फंक्शन उद्घाटनाचा जो समारंभ होता त्या समारंभामध्ये शिवाजी विद्यापीठाच्या भूगोल विभागाचे माजी विभाग प्रमुख प्रोफेसर डॉक्टर के सी रमोत्रा सर यांनी अतिशय चांगल्या पद्धतीने थोडक्यात ह्या आजच्या वेबिनारची जी थीम आहे विषय आहे जो विषय आहे त्या विषयाच्या संदर्भामध्ये चांगल्या पद्धतीने मार्गदर्शन केलं. त्याचबरोबर दुसऱ्या सेशनमध्ये की नोट ऍड्रेस की नोट स्पीकर म्हणून या ठिकाणी पार्वतीबाई चौगुले कॉलेजमधील भूगोल विभागाचे विभाग प्रमुख प्रोफेसर डॉक्टर आणि माझे प्रिन्सिपल प्रोफेसर डॉक्टर एन एन सावंत या ठिकाणी की नोट स्पीकर म्हणून उपस्थित राहिले आणि रेन वॉटर हार्वेस्टिंगच्या संदर्भामध्ये आणि ग्राउंड वॉटर रिचार्ज संदर्भामध्ये त्यांनी सुद्धा अतिशय चांगल्या पद्धतीनं मार्गदर्शन केलं. वास्तविक पाहता मार्गदर्शनासाठी आवश्यक असणारा जो वेळ आहे तो वेळ ऑनलाईन कार्यक्रम असल्यामुळे फारसा मिळाला नाही, परंतु तेवढ्या कालावधीमध्ये सुद्धा उत्तम प्रकारे मार्गदर्शन त्यांनी केलेलं आहे. पहिला सेशन जो होता त्या पहिल्या सेशनमध्ये गोगटे जोगळेकर कॉलेज रत्नागिरीच्या भूगोल विभागाचे विभाग प्रमुख डॉक्टर सुरेंद्र ठाकूर देसाई सर यांनी सुद्धा ग्राउंड रेन वॉटर हार्वेस्टिंग या विषयावरती अतिशय सखोल मार्गदर्शन त्या ठिकाणी केलेलं आहे आणि या सेशनचं चेअरपर्सन म्हणून आणि पाहुण्याची ओळख करून दिली त्याबद्दल डॉक्टर अनिल येडगे सर या ठिकाणी उपस्थित राहिले, त्यांचेही मी या ठिकाणी आभार मानतो. आणि दुसरा जो सेशन झाला त्या दुसऱ्या सेशनमध्ये चीफ एक्झिक्युटिव्ह ऑफिसर मिनरल फाउंडेशन ऑफ गोवा याचे डॉक्टर सचिन तेंडुलकर यांनीही ग्राउंड वॉटर रिचार्ज कशा पद्धतीनं केला पाहिजे आणि त्याच्यासाठी आवश्यक असणाऱ्या वेगवेगळ्या प्रकारच्या जे बारकावे आहेत ज्या उपयुक्त असणाऱ्या बाबी आहेत त्या बाबींच्या संदर्भामध्ये अतिशय सखोल अशा पद्धतीनं मार्गदर्शन त्यांनी केलेलं आहे. त्याबद्दल दोन्ही महाविद्यालयाच्या भूगोल विभागाच्या वतीनं मी आणि ऑर्गनायझिंग कमिटीच्या वतीनं मी ह्या सर्व रिसोर्स पर्सन आणि साधन व्यक्तींचं किनॉटर स्पीकरचं शतशः आभार व्यक्त करतो. आणि शेवटचा जो कार्यक्रम आहे व्हॅलिडिक्टरीचा, या व्हॅलिडिक्टरीच्या कार्यक्रमासाठी आवर्जून वेळात वेळ काढून या ठिकाणी उपस्थित राहिल्याबद्दल पार्वतीबाई चौगुले कॉलेजच्या प्रिन्सिपल डॉक्टर शैला घंटी मॅडम यांचंही मी दोन्ही विभागाच्या वतीनं महाविद्यालयांच्या वतीनं आणि आपल्या सर्वांच्या वतीनं आभार व्यक्त करतो. आणि या कार्यक्रमाच्या नियोजनासाठी आणि सातत्यानं कुठल्याही प्रकारचं कार्यक्रम आयोजित करण्यासाठी आम्हाला मार्गदर्शन करणारे, प्रेरणा देणारे, प्रोत्साहन देणारे आमचे प्राचार्य डॉक्टर बी एस बलवंत सर यांनी सकाळी इनॉग्रल फंक्शन उद्घाटनाच्या कार्यक्रमामध्ये सुद्धा अध्यक्षपद भूषवलं आणि आता या समारोपाच्या समारंभामध्येही अध्यक्षपद भूषवलं, त्याबद्दल सरांचंही मी या ठिकाणी आभार व्यक्त करतो. आणि अध्यक्षांच्या पूर्व परवानगीनं हा सगळा कार्यक्रम या ठिकाणी आज संपन्न झाला असं जाहीर करतो. पुन्हा एकदा सर्व सहभागी प्राध्यापक, विद्यार्थी, रिसोर्स पर्सन आणि प्रमुख पाहुणे यांचं मी महाविद्यालयाच्या वतीनं ऋण व्यक्त करून या ठिकाणी हा कार्यक्रम संपला असं जाहीर करतो. धन्यवाद.
आपल्याला एक मिनिट, आपल्याला जी फीडबॅकची लिंक आहे तर लिंक चॅट बॉक्स मध्ये आणि व्हॉट्सअप ग्रुप वर पाठवली जाईल आणि ती भरली की तुम्हाला तुमच्या ईमेल ऍड्रेस वरती तुमचं सर्टिफिकेट मिळेल. तर सर्वांनी एक दोन मिनिटं अजून चालू राहील हे वेबिनारचं. दिवटे सर चॅट बॉक्स मध्ये तुम्हाला फीडबॅकची लिंक देतील आणि नंतर मग तुम्हाला ईमेल वर सर्टिफिकेट मिळेल. त्याचबरोबर आपल्या व्हॉट्सअप ग्रुप वरती सुद्धा फीडबॅक लिंक दिली जाईल.
गायकवाड सर लिंक तुम्ही शेअर करा, मला शेअर करता येत नाही इकडून चॅट बॉक्स मध्ये.
गायकवाड सर डिक्लेअर करा.
हा ओके ओके सर. थँक्यू टू ऑल पार्टिसिपंट, सर्वांना खूप खूप धन्यवाद. स्पेशल